This is Star, age 8. This is Christy, age 7. This is Eric, age 7. This is Miko, age 8. These children and others like them will try to make you understand what they're talking about on Child's Play. And here is the host of Child's Play, Bill Cullen.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
All right.
Thank you very much, and welcome to you to Child's Play, a game for grown-ups. Well, we had a rather busy day last time we were on the air. Our current champion, a young lady by the name of LaVon Bartlett, she went to work and won the big bid on the $5,000, and now in her fourth day, she has to her credit $7,300. Welcome back, LaVon.
Thank you.
All right. You did a very, very good job. How do you feel now that you're $7,300 richer?
It's unbelievable.
LaVon told me when she won the $5,000, that's all she wanted to do, just get in there once and go all the way through, and you did.
That's it.
With 12 seconds left to spare.
I can't believe that.
Shall you and I together, although you two have already spoken, shall you and I together say hello to your challenger, ladies and gentlemen, William Franklin. Welcome, William.
Thank you.
You're welcome. What in your past or your immediate future would you like us to know about, William?
Well, right now, presently, I am a junior at Cal State University Northridge, majoring in biology, planning to become a dentist in less than 2 years, hopefully. And I work with some kids. They're a little older than your kids, and only thing about those kids, they go home at 3 o'clock. They don't stay with me all the time, so I love kids.
Oh, you do a bit of teaching, do you?
Well, no, I'm a teacher's aide at one of the junior highs in the area that I live in.
That's very interesting. Yeah. Is that part of your educational process?
No, it's not. It's just that I like being around kids, and I decided to take that job until my internship started as far as my dentist career.
Marvelous. A good way to spend your time in school. Let's hope all that work with kids has taught you something about kids. If you're all set, let's get started with Child's Play. We aimed, as you know, our cameras at children 5 to 9 years of age, and we asked them to interpret some everyday words. Your job, of course, will be to guess what those words are. Going to begin the guessing, as we usually do, with our champions. So, LaVon, you're first in the box, so you pay particularly close attention. Of course, it pays for both of you to pay attention, because it'll probably trickle down to one or the other. Here's word number one for the people at home. Let's show them the word you're playing for. Well, look who's here. Demon Describer. This, ladies and gentlemen, is our 7-year-old bit of a genius from New York City, Sasha Segan. And here's the way he describes the first word. Sasha.
In cartoons, they've sort of made it into a joke, like there's a sign that says CZ, those two words, 25 cents. So the guy looks in the telescope. Now he says, I don't see one. And another guy's at the other end of the telescope, stretching a plate on a rubber band. And then, let's go to the rubber band, and the plate flies. So he says, I see it, I see it, I see thee. Those two words, it's coming right at me. Splat. Yes.
I heard Sasha do a lot of descriptions, but I never heard one like that before. Based on the description you heard, LaVon, what do you think we're looking for?
Flying object.
Nope, not the right answer. Now, William, remember what you have just heard and add to that this information imparted by a 7-year-old from Maryland, Angela Stone. Angela, please.
It's like a frisbee, and it twirls around and round in space, and it has like letters and numbers on it, and it has these weird looking lights and rays that go down. And little people are in it, weird, that have like little, like ants. They're like little giant ants, and they have like antennas, and sometimes they have little stars coming out.
All right, now, put that together. That's Angela Stone. Angela's from Maryland. Added to Sasha's description, what do you think we're looking for?
She said, I guess with the little people inside the ship, I'm going to say a flying saucer.
Flying saucer is the right answer, William. Okay. That is William Franklin, who hops off to a lead 1-0, and we'll be back with Child's Play. But right now, would you watch this, please? See you in a little while. So here we are back again, and thank you for staying with us. Let's get set for a brand new word, and this time, William, we are going to begin with you. Okay. Before we do anything else, we will, as usual, show the people at home and here in the studio the word you're playing for. Okay, there's the word up there. And first description comes from Christy Simpson. Christy is 7 years old, and here's how she describes this word. Christy?
Two boys. One's in San Francisco, and one's at my school, the one that I said already. His name is Roland. And one's name is Mark. The one at my school's name is Rowan. He's in fifth grade. Ugh. Well, he's the cutest of all his brothers. He has three brothers. My friend Elena gets his brother Marlon. And my friend Wendy, she gets his brother Baha. What a different name. And then my friend Stormy, she gets Jubby. And I get the cutest of all, Roland. Hello.
We have just discovered a new star, I think. Based on the description, William, what do you think the word is we're looking for?
Oh, she's darling. I guess she was making all these arrangements between two people, boy and girl. I'm going to say couples.
No, very good. But I think you'll find out that her description was even better than that. Now, Levon, listen, remember that. Listen to this. Here's Alexandra Sorota, 7 years old, with further information on that word. Alexandra.
Well, I'm like when you're in love with somebody and you really like them a lot and they might not like you, but you might like them. Well, like you feel like kissing them, but you don't really. And like when you see them, you look at them a lot and you look at him and you think he's handsome.
Thank you, Alexandra, for that bit of information. All right. So far, you've had Christy's opinion and Alexandra's opinion. Levon, what do you think the word is?
Oh, well, I have two words, so I'll say boyfriend.
Nope. The other break for you, William. It's coming back to you. You have two pieces of information, and there's not much going to be said here. You're going to have to pick it up quickly from Molly Macklin, 8 years old. Same word, please, Molly.
Well, really, I had one on two guys, and... Well, and I think he had one on, they both had one on me, and it's like puppy love.
Based on that, William, what do you come up with?
Well, I've had one on a lot of girls. I'm going to say a crush.
Absolutely, William, you got it. See, it helps to have crushes in your past. I bet you've had some crushes, have you not, Levon?
Few.
Okay. Who of us have not at one time or another? It's 2-0, and we're over to you, Levon. So you're going to begin with this one. Watch carefully. Well, first of all, let's show the people at home. Our players do not see these words, naturally. Wouldn't make much point if they did. Anyway, describing this word is Kate Barno, who's 6 years old. Kate, what do you think it is?
It's like... perhaps you're married and you have no kids, and then someone divorces you and you're living with no one, and it's really, really sad to you because you have no one staying with you. It doesn't feel comfortable with no one staying with you. You have no one to stay with you.
Thank you, Kate. That's a sad bit of a sad situation there. What do you think the word is?
Depressed.
No, depressed would fit it, but it's not what we're looking for. Okay, William, we have more information for you. Here's Candace Feinberg. Candace is 8 years old. Let's see what they learn in 2 years. Same word. Here's the description.
Well, it means you don't have anybody to really be around you,
And, like, you say, hey, can we be together? And they say, no, I have to go to my class or something. And you're really sad, and you really think they don't like you anymore. And I've been that way millions of times. And I really, really think you're sad. And then somebody else comes over to you, and you think this is your big chance to play with somebody. And they say, no, I have to go someplace and late for my class.
Oh.
And really, you have nobody to play with or do something with.
Oh, that's a shame, Candace. I feel for you. By golly, that description brought a tear to my glasses. Based on that, William, what do you think?
From as sad as she sounded, I'm going to say, was she lonely?
Lonely is the right word. Lonesome, lonely, we'll take. Yeah. It's amazing how a child's mind works. She's been that way millions of times. Sometimes I guess it feels just like that. Okay, we're coming up with a brand new word now for the people at home and here in our studio. Here's the word we're going to be playing for. Okay, this should be fun. Going to start with you, William. We have a 7-year-old. His name is Alan Schlechter. And Alan, suppose you describe the word for us.
Yes, I studied about him. We did a play about him. And you think I don't know him? I even have a sword and a hat and a shield and a helmet and a... whatever. It's somebody who lived in the Middle Ages, and he had a golden sword, and he would raise it, and he would fight. Very fierceless, and lots of people were afraid if he had a sword fight. They would go... He would, like, be so afraid he would make these faces, and, like, he would go, oh, no, it's...
Alan, thank you. From this moment on, we will never think that Alan doesn't know what we're asking him. What do you think the word is, William?
He said lived in the Middle Ages. I'm going to say King Arthur.
You're right, William. Yes. Boy. We didn't think that Alan didn't know him, and we didn't think that you didn't know him, William. You have a 4-0 lead. When we come back to Child's Play, we'll shift gears and play the game for speed in the Fast Play Ride. See you in a minute.
Call toll-free now.
Time now for Fast Play. So if you'll both get ready, we're going to show you a series of children, and each child will be defining a different word. As soon as you think you know what it is, interrupt us. We'll stop everything and give you a chance to answer it. In Fast Play, we double the points, so from now on, each correct answer is worth 2 points. When you hear the school bell, time's up there. Whoever's ahead wins the game, $500 and a chance at $5,000. Okay, ready to interrupt now? Here's Robert Cohen with the first word. Robert.
He was trying to get to India when he was over here in...
What do you think?
Christopher Columbus.
Right, and a very good description from Robert. Yeah. Trying to get to India. Okay, it's 5 for William. LeVon not scored yet. Here's Jessica Chase with the next one. Jessica.
His book's in it and you'll be quiet in it.
That's LeVon.
Library.
That's right. You have 2 points. 6-2. Ready now with your buttons. Here's the next one. Mara Gerstein. Mara.
It's a slippery thing that people go on.
What do you think?
Ice?
No. Wrong. Rest of the description is yours, LeVon. Listen closely. Mara, pick it up, please.
It's usually in the playground. It's fun. It has a ladder in the back.
What do you think?
Slide.
Slide's the right answer. You're getting close. Score 6-4. Next word, lovely name, Heath Elliott will describe it. Heath.
If you're heading south, north, or east, or west, it tells you where...
That's LeVon.
Compass.
We got a tie score. 6-6. LeVon and William, you're both at 6 points. Next word, ready to interrupt. Here is Chris Casamassima. Chris.
They celebrated his... birthday, and it's in Santa Claus.
This, LeVon.
Christmas.
8-6 is the score. LeVon's ahead. William, she beat you to the button. Here's the next one with Karen Strauss. Karen.
That is something that makes people alert. Like if there was a burglar break.
This time it's William.
Alarm.
Alarm's right. We're tied again at 8 apiece. Tie score. Both of you ready? Sasha Segan has it. Sasha.
This was our former president's brother, who is famous because people made jokes.
LaVon for the lead.
Billy Carter?
Right, you're in the lead. Score 10 for LaVon and 8 for William. Next word, Malik Duncan. Malik.
Well, it's something you eat. And it has tomatoes and lettuce.
William.
Salad.
Salad's right. Malik Duncan did it. 10-10. Both of you ready again. Here's the next one. Robin Carstensen. Carstensen. Robin.
You look at it, and it has lots of pictures, and there's different ones like National Geographic.
LaVon.
News.
No, wrong answer. Rest of it is all yours, William. Robin, pick it up, please.
Rick and Time and an electric company.
What do you think, William?
Could it be a magazine?
Could be a magazine. You're ahead,
very
William.
Good. Very good.
Score is 10 to 12 to 10. Next one, Shannon Pennell. Shannon, please.
He has red cheeks, and he loves red, and...
LaVon's going to take a chance.
Santa Claus?
Good chance. We're tied again. 12-12. All right, that's the time's up bell. What that means, we're in a tie score, 12 apiece. What that means is this one is for the game. Both of you get ready. The one who gets this one right wins it. Word to be described by Marta Weiss. Marta.
Usually rich people have them. And they wear these funny looking hats. Like...
For the game, LaVon.
Chauffeur?
Chauffeur is right. Game again. Congratulations. Come on over here. LaVon, you did it. Boy. You played well. Let me, before we go one step further, may I please thank William Franklin. William,
you.
You played a beautiful game against a good champion.
Thank you.
We have some nice gifts for you.
Thank
Thanks
you.
For being with us on Child's Play. Congratulations. He was some opponent. You two went right down to the wire. You have $500, and we'll be back and play triple play and give you a shot at $5,000 more. You're working on $7,800. We'll be back right after this. Okay, you got the $500. That brings you up to $7,800. Well done. Time now for the $5,000 in our triple play game. Let me explain. We asked our Child's Play kids to write brief definitions of simple words. And then we took three definitions per word, each written by a different child, A, B, or C. Now, you have a total of 45 seconds to get six words. We pay you $100 a word, as you know, because you've been here and you've been through all this. But if you get them all, as you did last time, you pick up another $5,000. Not bad, huh?
Not bad at all.
Okay, good luck to you. Hope you do it. Bring in the clock. Take a deep breath, and time will not begin until you tell me the letter. Okay, let's see what happens.
B.
A small stick with a red tip.
Match.
Right, next.
A.
A top of a ship.
B.
52 cards.
C.
It's the boardwalk.
Deck.
Correct. Next.
A.
Something lovers do.
B.
They use their lips.
Kiss.
Right.
B.
Next. A round juicy fruit with a smooth skin and a pit.
C.
It's purple. Its inside is yellow and orange.
Plum.
Right. Next.
B.
It makes your breath smell.
C.
Something you wear around your neck that will scare Dracula.
Garlic.
Correct.
B.
Next.
B.
Something that has no curves.
C.
It is the opposite of crooked.
Straight.
Correct. That's six again. You did it again. Oh, ha, ha, ha. Oh, boy. Oh, you are all right. You are all right. You work well under pressure. What a marvelous job, LaVon. You didn't have as much time. It took you longer. Last time you had 12 seconds. You know, you brought it down to 4 seconds this time, but that doesn't matter because you picked up the $5,000. Your total winnings, $12,800, and you'll be back with us again next time. We'll see you in just a moment. Right now, would you watch us, please? We'll be back. If you like money, you'll love LaVon. And if you like kids, you'll love Child's Play. Bye. Want to wave out there?
Some departing contestants receive Black & Decker's Dustbuster Cordless Vac, a light, powerful vacuum for small, fast cleanups. Make short work of little messes the Dustbuster. And with Maxell Videotape, you can play your recordings over and over and still get better color resolution, sharper images, and clearer sound. Maxell, it's worth it. A tray and Lipton iced tea in the winter. Why not, says Don Meredith. You drink other cold drinks in the winter. Why not Lipton iced tea? Made from tea bags, dandy tasting. Hamilton Beach's Deluxe Drink Master Milkshake Machine with two mixing speeds. Ideal for making perfect milkshakes, diet drinks, omelets, and more from Hamilton Beach, Goville. And all of the children appearing on Child's Play this week receive Yamaha HS500, a 25-note portable keyboard with five electronic musical games, features five different instrument sounds. Learn music the fun way with the handy sound from Yamaha. Or Crown Japan CSC 925 stereo radio cassette recorder delivers a hefty 7 watts of music power. Features auto recording, AF/FM tuning, and stereo wide mode for expanded stereo sound. Crown Japan. This is Gene Woods speaking for Child's Play. I'm Mark Goodson, television production.
You're watching Game Show Network.
Hi, I'm Cassie Feldman. I'm 8 years old from New York City.
You will meet Cassie Feldman and these other children today as we play the game of kids and definitions, Child's Play. And here's the star of Child's Play, Bill Cullen.
Oh, there. Thank you. Thank you very much. You're a nice bunch. Thank you, and welcome to Child's Play, the game in which children define words that grown-ups try to guess. Hey, our last sweepstakes winner is with us today. You'll meet him later on. His name is David Tillman, and he's from Memphis, Tennessee. He and the other kids will be back later in the show to try to help the winner of today's game go for the big money. Speaking of the winner, speaking of the big money, let's say hello to our champion. Ladies and gentlemen, her fourth day. Her name is Catherine Rose. Catherine has $11,900. Welcome back, Miss Rose. You got so much money, I'm going to call you Miss Rose now. No more of that Catherine stuff now.
Okay.
So, Miss Rose, tell us about you.
Well, I'm a registered nurse, and I live in Cardiff-by-the-Sea.
You're going to get married.
And I'm going to be married November 20th.
Wow.
And I've got a lot of money. I think I'm going to buy a new car with air conditioning.
A new car?
Because my air conditioning broke down.
Oh.
Yes. I have a 10-year-old car, and I don't like it.
Oh. Do you realize you're driving a heap that are older than our kids? Let us welcome her opponent, ladies and gentlemen, Jim Shea, as I live and breathe. Hi, Jim.
All right.
How you doing?
I'm terrific, thank you.
I like your forelock there. As you bob your head up and down and sort of, that's cute. Do you play the violin?
No.
What do you do?
No, I'm in foreign sales of motion pictures, so I get to go to Europe 2 or 3 times a year to sell pictures all around the world.
Sensational. What else about you, Jim O'Boy?
Yeah, well, I live in Hollywood, and I have two young children, Michael and Tiffany.
Okay. Yeah. Now you know a little about Jim, you know a little bit about Catherine. Oh, before we begin the game, I want to remind you that these are our final 2 weeks on Child's Play, and before our program goes off the air, which will occur on September 16th, we are going to be, between now and then, showing you some of the definitions from shows of the past, definitions that you have asked to see again. Some of them will be coming up later on in today's show, so if you're interested, be sure to stay tuned. Right now, let's get on with the game. Okay?
Yeah.
Catherine, we begin with you. For the audience at home and here in the studio is the word we're going to be playing for. A reminder, as always, that our two players never see this word, only the audience. And we have Tamara Wisdom. Isn't that a lovely name? Tamara Wisdom is 8 years old, and she's about to describe word number one. Tamara, please.
My parents have been married for 10 years, and they haven't got divorced yet. And there's my daddy and my, this word does some of the chores, but sometimes we have to do the chores and we have to help her out. Like, and she's having another baby, and my had a picture taken inside of her stomach, and she's going to have a boy.
Thank you, Tamara. Tamara Wisdom, with a few words of saying. That seemed like a pretty good definition to me, Catherine. What'd it do for you?
Well, she's got her daddy and she has her mommy.
Mommy or mother is the right answer. So, a couple of good first guesses here. Catherine, you have a 1-0 lead, and we'll be back with Child's Play right after a memorable definition from a past show. This is a young lady named Pamela Dilworth. Pamela is 6 years old. She's from New York, and she is defining the same word, the word mother. Pamela, please.
This person to me is nice because she loves me. We're very cuddly, and she gave me a purse to make. She bought a little kit. Should I show? And that's what's nice about her. She gives me these little special things. She'll give you things like my pocketbook. She'll give you things like my box. And she'll also give you necklaces. That are very, very nice. And they're very nice people. And they have you born. And they can only be married for 6 months. And then they have the baby.
Talk to you later about that, Pamela. Back in just a moment. Okay, got a 1-0 score here. We're back, as you can plainly see. We have a new word. We're going to begin with you, Jim. Give you a chance to get in the game with us. Here for the audience at home and in the studio, the word we're playing for. Okay, everybody knows but our players. Here to describe it, an 8-year-old whose name is Chastity Stevens. Chastity, dear.
My boyfriend's name is Dustin, and sometimes when anybody's picking on me or anything, he says, oh, go pick on someone your own size, even to the 8th graders or the 6th graders or the 7th graders, 5th graders, all the high grades, the low grades. He says it to everybody. Even Michael, his best friend. Why would he do that to his best friend? I don't understand him. So I got a new one.
Thank you, Chastity. We had a surprise ending there. I don't know how much that helped you, Jim. Good luck. Remember children describing and come up with a word.
Well, if he's doing all that, he's her champion.
Champion is excellent. It's not quite it. Same word for you, Catherine. You get a break. Here is the same word being worked on by a 7-year-old, Gina Rizzo. Gina.
I went to school, and they call this bathroom the Bloody Mary bathroom because they hear those noises like they see blood, but these kids, they spray this the ketchup on the walls, and they go ooh like that, and then some people, they go there, and they're that word. They just walk, go wash their hands. They don't hurry. They just walk, and if their shoe is lace, they tie it, and then they go. Well, I'm not scared.
How do you feel when you go in that bathroom?
I feel scary. Even though I know that they spray the ketchup, but I'm not sure. My friend said, oh, why don't you taste it? It might be ketchup. Aren't you hungry? I pretend I'm on a diet.
Oh, I've heard about those bathrooms. Thank heavens for little trees. Jim, you have a shot at the word we're looking for. I know, Catherine, I'm confused. I don't know how well you're going to do. I wish you luck. What's the word?
Well, you have to go into a Bloody Mary bathroom. You must be awful brave.
You're right. You know how to play this game. That was a remarkably good job coming up from Brave out of that, don't you think, Jim?
Yes, indeed. Yeah.
So we have ourselves a 2-0 score here, and we're going to begin with you, Catherine. First of all, for the audience, here's the word. Okay, there it is up there. And we have a young lady from New York who's 6 years old. Lovely name, Tia Perry. All right, Tia.
Oh, they lived in the desert, and they had nothing to eat.
How did they dress?
They dressed in, hyena. And, really, hyenas do live in the desert, and they sound terrible. And they, really, they're like, the wives make hyena dresses. When the hyena dies, then the lady, which is the wife of the sewed up the hyena material, and they took it, and then they made a little dress. And even the suits for the men.
Thank you, Tia. Tia Perry. Well, you've been doing very well, Catherine. What are you going to do with that one?
I didn't know hyenas wore clothes, but I'm going to say nomads.
Nomads is good, and that's not it. So, Jim, we're over to you. Now, remember, we're working on the same word, and here's Angela Castellano. She's 5 from New Jersey. Angela.
Oh, that was a long, 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 long time ago. Where I think I seen some on television, like they sit on rocks or something, and the table was made out of rock, but it's not really a table like ours. It's like table all stuffed with rocks, and I don't know how they could put the food on that thing. I was in school in that days, and even where there was no supermarkets or anything there, nothing. They didn't have nothing, no money or nothing. So they were really poor people.
Thank you, Angela. That's true, as it goes. Your problem, Jim?
Well, with Neanderthals and rocks, that sounds like Neanderthal to me.
No. Good try. Back to Catherine for the final shot at this word. Johannes Richard from Washington, D.C. Richards. He's 9 years old. Johannes?
Well, they were prehistoric man. Some people say they lived in the dinosaur age, and some people say they didn't. They were all hairy, and they were very untidy. Some people say that when they were in love, they used to take their club and knock the women on the head so the women would be conked out. And then they would drag them by their hand, take them to their cave, and then when the woman woke up, she would be married to them.
Thank you, Johannes. Oh, well, no comment. Shot at the word, Catherine.
Well, if they're dirty and hairy, they must be cavemen.
That's it. So we have a 3 for Catherine and nothing for Jim. We'll be back with our fast play round right after this memorable definition from our past shows. We have a young lady, a young gentleman, one of our originals, Eric Vaught. He's 7 from Los Angeles. And Eric is going to define Dolly Parton. Stand back.
I bet she can float on the water easily. She's a star. She acts. And, really acts. She's a star. And she'll do lots of things, but she will never find her dress size.
Frankly, I don't care. Back in a minute. Thank you. Okay, 3 for Catherine. Jim hasn't scored. Jim, it's catch-up time. You can do it here. Yep. Fast play, and from now on, each child will divine a different word. As soon as you recognize the word, interrupt with your signal. Each right answer will be worth 2 points when you hear the school bell. Time is up, and whoever is ahead wins the game. $500 and a chance at $5,000. Both of you now ready to interrupt the moment you know what the word is. Here with the first one is Paul Varjan. Paul.
There are 7 days in one of the...
Catherine?
Week.
Correct. Score 5-0. Yeah. Next word, Rosamond Musson. Rosamond.
Bears do this, and a lot of kind of animals do this.
Catherine.
Hibernate.
Right.
Oh.
Good try. Jim, you better get moving. It's 7-0. And here with the next word, Sarah Feynman. Sarah?
I think they come from up
in the sky, and they fly around. Sometimes when you lose a tooth,
Yes, Jim.
That'd be a fairy.
Right, Jim. Score 7-2. Okay. Next word, Allison Muscat. Allison.
Something that sometimes mothers sing to you at...
Catherine.
Lullaby.
Correct. 9-2. Here's Adam Codrey with the next one. Adam.
This city is very crowded because it's so crowded they have people which are paid for pushing people into a bus.
Jim's going to take a chance.
That's the subways of New York.
No, Jim. No, I see you're thinking, but it's not right. There's a little bit left, Catherine, so listen carefully. Adam, please.
And it's the capital of Japan.
Well, that was that enough?
Tokyo.
Yes. Score 11-2. Here is Alexander Glass. Alexander?
There are little things go on the shirt right here that have numbers on them. They tell who you are.
Yes, Jim.
That's a bad.
It is Jim. Score 11-4. Darren Mitchell with the next one. Darren.
He was a famous person whose first name was Walt, and he made all characters.
Catherine.
Walt Disney.
Correct. Score 13-4. Jennifer Libson. Jennifer.
In baseball, he says, "You're out."
Jim.
That's the umpire.
Correct. 13-6. David Lerner. David.
Well, coffee has it.
Catherine?
Caffeine.
Right. Score 15-6. Jonathan Reese. Jonathan?
There's two kinds of them. A refractor and a reflector.
Jim?
Those are lenses.
Nope. Nope. You have the rest of it all. Yours, Catherine. Hear him out. Jonathan, please.
And you can look into them, and you can see the planets and stars and anything else in the sky.
Catherine?
A telescope.
Is right. Telescope's yeah. Right. Jim, you were close, but Keith, that's it. Catherine, you won it again. Congratulations. You keep rolling on. You and Old Man River, congratulations. Well, Jim Shea, old boy, before you leave, I thank you very much. You came up against a super player in our current champion, Catherine, here. You did very well. We have some nice gifts for you and all of us here at Child's Play. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jim.
Thank you. Good luck.
Catherine, you have another $500. Now you're going to have a chance to win $5,000 more in our turnabout game. To help you go for the big money, we have five of our Child's Play children here in the studio. We'll be back, meet the children, give you your chance at $5,000 more right after this message for you. We're back to Child's Play. You have $12,400. Chance to add another $5,000 to that. You do that by playing our turnabout game. And here they come, our turnabout children. Come on in, gang. There they are. You notice we're getting a lot of our veterans, if you can use that word, for these children back with us. For instance, here's one of our old friends, one of our very originals, Sasha. Sasha, introduce yourself. Everyone else does.
Okay, I'm Sasha Segan. I'm 9 years old, and I come from Brooklyn, New York, New York.
You know, the other day I made a mistake. I introduced you doing one of the definitions. I said you were still 8, but you've aged. You're 9 now, huh?
Yeah.
That happens to all of us, Sasha, I guess. You know, we've had a lot of fan mail about you. Everybody seems to want to know, if you read the encyclopedia for fun, now that might seem like a silly question, but give it an honest answer, do you?
Depends on which encyclopedia.
So you do. You don't read those little easy ones, you read the hard ones.
Yep.
What are the names of your favorite authors?
Well, I'm really into fantasy, and I like C.S. Lewis and J.R.R. Tolkien.
Holy mackerel, you are indeed into fantasy. One more question, and then I won't bother you anymore. What do you want to be when you get a lot older, or somewhat older?
Well, I haven't decided what job I'll take, but I want to go to Harvard and be a Harvard graduate.
Thank you, Sasha Segan.
Are you the real Bill Cullen?
I sometimes wonder, Sasha. I'll tell you, I'm not sure, and you won't find it in any encyclopedia. Robin, would you introduce yourself?
Hi, my name is Robin Cassie. I'm in the third grade, and I come from Long Beach, California.
Cassie, dear.
Hi, I'm Cassie Feldman. I'm 8 years old from New York City.
David.
Hi, my name is David Tillman. I'm in the fourth grade, and I come from Memphis, Tennessee.
And you're our sweepstakes winner from there. Gary.
Hi, Mr. Cohen.
Hi.
I'm Gary Cohen. I'm in the fourth grade, and I'm 8 years old, and I'm from Van Nuys, California.
Thank you, Gary, and thanks to all of you. We're going to show you 7 words, one at a time. You have to define them so the children will say the word. You begin the describing to Sasha. If you get stuck, you can pass. We'll come back to the word at this time. We get $100 a word to you. If you get them all, you win $5,000. The children divide $100 for each right word. Get all 7. They split $1,000. Have a total of 45 seconds on the clock. Watch up there. The moment you see the word start with Sasha, good luck.
Okay, you do this to an ice cream. You lick it.
Next word, Robin.
Okay, you feed this to your horses. It's...
Hey.
Next word, Cassie.
This is what you cook in. It's not... It's the oven.
Pass.
Another word for oven.
Pass.
Next word, David.
And this is a fruit, and it has fuzz on it, and it's like a nectarine.
Peach.
Good.
Next word, Gary.
And this is what you do your dirty clothes. It's called your...
Wash.
Another
Laundry.
Word for wash.
Good.
Yes, next word,
okay,
Sasha.
And this is a type of material that a lot of things are made out of. It's like cellophane bags, but it's thicker, it's harder, you can see through it.
Plastic!
Next
Good.
Word, Robin.
And this is something that swims in the ocean. Tuna.
Fish.
Good.
Next word, Cassie.
Okay.
Stove! Yeah!
That's it! Two old clothes pull you through. We'll be back right after these words.
Hey! Hey! Make me normal size, please! Whoa! Those darn programmers! Oh! Hi! I'm Lucy, and I'm the freshest, fastest, and coolest way to turn cyber letters! If you like Wheel of Fortune, you'll love Wheel 2000! Everyone in your family can play along and learn something too. What about that? Did I mention the fabulous prizes? And we're not talking Rice Aroni here, buddy!
Wheel 2000 starts this fall on Game Show Network!
Oh, you got great helpers.
Yes.
If you like kids, you'll love Child's Play. We'll see you.
Some departing contestants receive an ice cream freezer just like the good old days. Now you can make your own ice cream in this Richmond Cedar. 5-quart electric freezer in just 30 minutes. Uses table of rock salt. Be the hit of the party with the thermostatically controlled electric crepe maker. Non-stick 7.5-inch baking surface includes recipes. Kentucky Fried Chicken gift certificate checks and an insulated thermal bag to keep things fresh. Kentucky Fried Chicken, we do chicken right. Rent, Rinse, and Vac, the do-it-yourself steam cleaning system that gives you professional cleaning results at a fraction of the cost. And all of the children appearing in Child's Play this week will receive from Camelot.
One and go. And for 2 crowns, this will do to be a win for you if you get this one. Stephanie, here's the question. What writer created the fictional character Perry Mason, A. Dashiell Hammett or B. Earl Stanley Gardner?
A. Dashiell Hammett.
A. Dashiell Hammett, is she right? Oh, doggone it, that would have been a win for you. All right, we're back to Margaret. You have 4 seconds to stop the board and go. All right, for 1 crown in the win, Margaret, it is. What group had a number one hit with the song Waterfalls? A. Salt and Pepper or B. TLC?
A. Salt and Pepper.
A. Salt and Pepper, is she right? No! All right, we're back to Stephanie. You have 4 seconds to stop the board and go. All right, for 2 crowns in the win, here's the question. What TV series often featured appearances by a character named Clem Diddlehopper? A. Hee-Haw or B. The Red Skelton Show?
Red Skelton Show,
B. The Red Skelton Show. Is she right? Yes, she is, for the win. All right, congratulations, Stephanie. I can hear in your voice that you knew that was right. Way to go. You won computer software.
Thank you very much.
All right. You're very welcome. Hey, Margaret, that was a great game.
Thank you. We tried.
You did try, and you did a good job. And for which you get 2 crowns. That means you get a $25 gift certificate for each one, so $50 in gift certificates from Macmillan Publishing.
Wow, okay.
Isn't that nice? In addition to the music collection that you won earlier. And I hope you and Justin had a good time tonight.
We had a great time, and thank you so much.
Thank you so much. It was nice getting to chat with you a bit here, and you take care.
You too.
All right, Stephanie, way to go.
Way to go, yeah.
Now, were you a Red Skelton fan?
Yes and no.
Yeah, I used to sit up in bed with my grandmother and watch him and Clem Diddlehopper and all those great characters he used to do.
Yes.
Now, do we have a happy household there with Dwayne Brandon
yes.
and Terry? Can we hear some noise from these fellas?
Can you guys yell some noise?
Yay for Mom. All right. right.
Very
where
excited.
Go. All right. Hey, Stephanie, thanks so much. Enjoy all your great prizes.
Thank you.
All right, you take care.
Bye.
Hey, folks, we done did it. We gave away some great prizes and had a lot of fun in the meantime. And we can do this thing again if you're staying here on Game Show Network and watching us on Trivia Track. So we'll be back and do some more a little later on. We'll see you soon.
Some of our players may receive the following. The 101 Greatest Country Hits from KTEL. 5 decades of classic country on 10 CDs or cassettes, featuring Willie Nelson, Johnny Cash, Marty Robbins, Eddie Rabbit, and much more. Macmillan Reference USA, a leading reference publisher. Got a question? Get an answer in a Macmillan Reference book. Available at bookstores everywhere.
Watching Game Show Network.
Ladies and gentlemen, Gary Moore.
Ship ahoy! Loop your poop deck. All that good nautical talk like that. And welcome to the Titanic version of To Tell the Truth. And by George, look who is here basking on the sun deck. We have our panel, Bill Cullen and Peggy Cass. There's a twosome. And over here we got Kitty Carlisle and Tom Poston. And by George, here comes our associate producer, Rog Peterson, who is serving a spot of liquid nourishment. He's up from steerage for the day. Now, panel, as if you didn't know, you are seated on and amongst memorabilia from all of the world's greatest ocean liners. For instance, some of this stuff comes from the RMS Queen Mary, some comes from the Normandy, to name just two. And incredibly, one man has purchased practically every available item from virtually every passenger liner that has ever sailed the briny deep. And let us meet that gentleman now.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Gene Darcy.
Number two.
My name is Gene Darcy.
Number three.
My name is Gene Darcy.
And panel, your job remains the same, to discover which one of those three gentlemen is indeed Gene Darcy, and here is his salty saga. It says, I, Gene Darcy, have bought virtually every item from the world's greatest ocean-going vessels. From such magnificent luxury liners as the RMS Queen Mary, the RMS Queen Elizabeth, the Normandy, and the SS United States, I have obtained everything from deck chairs and nautical equipment to a solid gold dessert service for the royal use of King George and Queen Mary. Now let's take a look at some of the items I have brought along the day. These life preservers are called dress rings, and they're used when the ship is in port, and they're really just there for show. Now here, this is a ship's wheel, and this was actually a replacement, or what is called a backup wheel, for the Antilles, which sank in the Caribbean. It's all teak wood, and it is solid bronze, beautifully refinished, and it sells for $695. And, let me see. Now, this is an unusual square bone china teapot with a square creamer and sugar, the finest example of Art Deco of its period. Everything is square for a very good reason. It stacks easier. The panel is sitting in English beech oak deck chairs, over 35 years old, And since the original pads were horsehair, we've had to make new ones. And finally, a roast beef cart, or trolley, from the Normandy. The metal is all coin silver, the wood is solid mahogany, and it sells for a solid $4,000. Goodies from this incredible treasure trove of riches have been sold to such celebrated collectors of nostalgia as Frank Sinatra, Fred Astaire, Prime Minister Edward Heath, and President Richard M. Nixon. Incidentally, I have bought other things of historical interest, too, but I do draw the line. Without batting an eye, I once turned down the chance to buy Alcatraz. Signed, Gene Darcy. And while we bring our good ship into port and a light for our panel desk, we'll stop and have a few commercials and be right back. Now, all three of these gentlemen say that they are Gene Darcy, a man who collects and sells items from the world's most illustrious ocean liners. And we'll start the question with, let's start with Kitty.
Thank you. Number one, those life preservers you say are dress rings. What kind of life preservers do you really use when you need one at sea?
Not those, very definitely.
They're not, they have no kapok or anything inside.
They do, but you wouldn't want to use one for that purpose.
I see. Number two, the beef cart that we see just there has a silver plaque on one side and it says Christoffel. What does that mean?
Well, it was in the Museum of the Christoffel, the people who originally rendered and made that particular beef cart.
Thank you. Number three, what does Christoffel make now?
Still makes silver.
Uh-huh, thank you. And number one, what did Mr. Nixon buy?
He bought a faucet.
What for?
To wash.
That's where he lives, in Wash.
Oh, number two, what did Mr. Sinatra buy?
Bought a urinal.
Oh, my goodness!
I'm sorry I asked. Number three, well, I lost my thread.
You certainly did.
Why are those chairs...
You lost your whole train.
And then Buzzer takes us down to Tom Poston, please.
Number three, where do you store these various artifacts that you buy? A
number of warehouses.
A number of them. Number three, who actually purchases from you?
All sorts of people, celebrities, the public, anybody interested in these memorabilia.
They are simply beautiful, and they evoke all kinds of ideas and images. Number two, do you have... a showroom, a store? Do you have a...
Well, we go from one hotel to another. At the moment, we're at the Park Sheraton Hotel.
Oh, I see. Number one, do you agree with that? Is that...
Yes,
that
the way
you
right.
Do?
That's
well,
right.
You have your... Do you have a store?
No, we have no permanent store. We just are on the road.
I was gonna ask number one, how do you let your potential customers know where you are and that you have these things for sale?
By advertising in the paper.
In each town you go to?
In each town, please.
Thank you.
And that takes us, please, to Peggy.
Well, I certainly don't want to say anything, but number three, the cup that I drank from was made in Poland. Now, would you please tell me what that was doing on one of your fine ships?
Must have been an error.
You mean it wasn't your cup?
Possibly not.
Oh, because I thought maybe it was from the Batory or something. Number one, whom did you purchase all this stuff from?
From the city of San Diego.
Oh, and number two, how much did you pay for all this stuff?
Well, in excess of $3 million for all the ships combined.
Did you have to make a down payment and the rest on the time payment plan, or did you just fork over $3 million?
No, it began with a very slow movement of the objects coming off the ship, and from that point on, we kept buying and buying anything that was available.
So number three, wasn't the Normandy burnt up or something?
Burnt up in New York Harbor in 1942.
Well, then, number one, how is it the stuff a little charred that you got off the Normandy?
No. The items from the Normandy...
Yes.
...that were saved, and also the items warehoused. In other words, there are many ship stores that are held for backup.
Okay. Now, number two, see the... Done.
And that takes place to Bill Collins.
Yeah, number three, I'll stay with you because we're talking about the Normandy. Do you know where the Normandy's, the ship's wheel from the Normandy happens to be now or in whose possession?
I do not.
Number two, I am more or less intrigued with things like this, and I'm very interested in getting something. For instance, bridge binoculars. There were many pairs of binoculars on the bridge of the Queen Elizabeth, for instance. Is that true?
That is true.
What would a pair of bridge binoculars cost if I were to come to your...
Well, anywhere from $115 to $250, depending upon the power.
Number one, are there still bridge binoculars in stock?
There are some, yes.
So there is a chance for me to get something like...
I know what to give you for your birthday.
How about number two? How about ship's bells? Now, there are more than one bell aboard a ship. There's one main bell, but are there any left from the Queen? I'm thinking particularly of the Queen Elizabeth one.
Yes, we have the Elizabeth Regina bells, and they are available.
Yeah, beautiful.
All righty, there goes a bell, not a ship's bell, but a balloting bell. We mark our ballots as the audience and I try to choose between number one, number two, and number three. We know the penalties, and well, I guess we don't know the penalties if you've just watched the show for the first time. They're $50 for each wrong vote, $500 if all of the votes are wrong. And Kitty starts.
Oh, thank you. I voted for number three. I think he's a refugee from Lloyd's of London.
three showing, and Tom, what are you doing, Donnie?
Oh, I was a little distracted. Every time I started to think of a question to ask, Peggy would say, "Ask him where I can get a sailor." No, she didn't. I ended up voting for number two because he looked like a guy who would not want Alcatraz.
So we've got two and we've got three, and we go to Peggy.
I am never speaking to you again. I voted for number two because I think he could sell, what do they say, icebox to the Eskimos.
We got a pair of twos and a three, and we have Bill Cullen. What do you want to do?
Well, I was very impressed by all the gentlemen, but again, I too was impressed by number two's presence. And I also hope, you know, that what he said was correct about the things available, because I am interested, so I voted for him. That has nothing to do with it. I just did.
All I know, next time I go to Sinatra's house, I'm going to look at the flower vase very carefully.
That's unworthy.
Meanwhile, let us find out who's the real one. Will the real Gene Darcy please stand up? There is Gene Darcy. Thank you, Gene. We'll be back to you in a minute. Number one, sir, what is your real name? What do you do?
I'm Bill Cox, and I'm a freelance fiction writer.
Good luck to you. Number three, sir, would you tell us about yourself?
My name is Sidney Remmett, and I am a construction inspector.
Ah. Mr. Darcy, what is the single most valuable item that you have sold?
Well, the single most valuable item that I have sold was a $100,000 ship's position mural, which was on the Queen Mary, and when you were dining, you were always able to tell at what position you were at sea.
Ah, yes, a very intricate deal,
yes,
as a matter of fact.
Yes, very intricate mechanism.
Thank you, Mr. Darcy, and thank you, gentlemen, for being with us on To Tell the Truth. Most of us who have been out of school more than a couple of years are kind of rusty on our Latin. I remember gallia est omnis partes et in divisa in
parte.
It meant Gloria eats onions in a partridge tree, is what the whole thing. But anyhow, we got a fella here who knows all about that, and he can fill you in on a lot of things you didn't know if you'll hang around. Now let us say hello to a young man who can take us back, in one way at least, to Roman times.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is David Dorch.
Number two.
My name is David Dorch.
Number three.
My name is David Dorch.
And here is a very interesting story, the story of David Dorch. It says, I, David Dorch, have literally catapulted into the limelight. You see, I actually construct and shoot modern catapults. As any self-respecting Roman can tell you, a catapult is a monstrous contraption used to hurl rocks to besiege castles and fortresses. In gentlemanly competition with other schools, my friends and I hurl our rocks simply to see how far they will go. Now, all of this is part of a Roman holiday fiesta, complete with costumes, a parade, and We even have chariot races. This is topped off with a bountiful banquet. Now, although the day was a big success, catapult-wise, no one set the world on fire. Whereas Roman catapults could heave a 500-pound boulder an incredible 200 yards, I could do no better than send a mere pebble of 75 pounds a paltry 100 feet. Nonetheless, when the day was over, I emerged as the national catapulting champion. Signed, David Dortch. And in case any of you haven't taken a close look at a catapult in the last few weeks, I have a model here that David supplied us with, and it's can't explain the whole thing to you, except you have to imagine that this is, we'll say, a couple hundred pound rock. Now, here is a chain and some levers with which it is wound up, and here is a counterweight over here. Now, when I push this down, hopefully this is going to be flung over in that direction, or else we're going to lose a couple of panelists. Here's the way it goes. Now, 200-pound rock, imagine. 500, there going to bing.
Very good.
And that's the way it works. So, let's start the questioning with the noblest Roman of them all, Mr. Tom Poston.
I'm very curious, number one, what releases the sling that holds that rock?
A pin at the end of the arm. The sling is hooked over and slips off this pin, and the sling opens up and releases the rock.
Thank you. Number two, what loads it? What causes the tension on that throwing arm?
Well, usually it's a cable that's attached to a winch. It's wound up either by hand or it's pulled back. And then there's a hook that's between two pieces of cable, one on the top and one on the bottom. And you pull the hook out and the two cables separate and the arm flies up and releases the rock.
I think I get that last part. But what causes the spring? What puts the tension on that, on the other part?
Oh, the counterweight.
One ton
worth of lead.
Oh,
yeah. Tom couldn't see from where he's sitting. You've got a very heavy weight over here, Tom.
Number three is that.
Oh. And that takes us to Peg, please.
Thank you. Number three, where do you go to school?
Antigua High in Antigua, Wisconsin.
Thank you. And number two?
Danbury High, Danbury, Connecticut.
And number one?
Park Tudor School in Indianapolis.
Thank you. Now, number two, who invented the catapult?
Well, it wasn't really invented by anyone's particular. Archimedes played a very great part of it in the Battle of Syracuse. He really developed the most modern form of that type that we use.
Okay. Now, number three, didn't they use catapults in the Bible? Aren't catapults mentioned in the Bible?
Yes, I think so. It was involved in the Battle of Jerusalem.
Thank you. Number one, did Caesar use catapults?
Yes, he did.
Where?
I do not know.
Well, that's all right. We're even. Neither do I. Number two, it's the same principle, is it not, of the slingshot?
No, it's not.
No?
No.
And from Peggy, we go to Bill Cullen.
Number three, once having succeeded with hurling these big rocks inside the castle, what was the weapon that they used in those same days to break down the gates, assuming they could get over them?
A battering ram.
And number one, about how many men did it require to operate a battering ram?
10 men.
Number two, your distance was not, although I admire your winning the championship, it was not an overly impressive distance. Are you going to work on improving your catapulting distance for the next contest, or?
Definitely, yes.
Is there going to be another contest?
Oh, yes, definitely there will be.
What school, number three, what school came closest to you?
Culver Military Academy.
And you go to school, number three, where?
In Tiggy High in Wisconsin.
There is a professor, number one, who seems to be behind all of this, who inspires, I think he's a language teacher. What is his name, the man who really helped you get organize these Roman games, as it were?
Bernard Barcio.
And that buzzer takes us, please, to Kitty.
Thank you. Number what, two, how did you get interested in this?
Well, it happened in physics class, as a matter of fact. The teacher was discussing trajectory, and I didn't go along with a lot of things he said, so the only way that you can find out about it is do something.
He said, try it.
Try it, and yeah. You like it.
Number three, how did the Romans manage to get 500 pounds on that thing? Did it take a lot of men to do it?
Yes, they would.
Thank you. Number one, is it one of the rules of the game that you have to load this thing single-handed?
No, it is not.
Well, then why don't you get a lot of people and load a 500-pound rock on it?
The machine could not take it.
It wouldn't hold it, I see. And number two, every weapon has a counter invention that comes along and makes it obsolete. What was the next thing that put the catapult out of business?
High walls, mainly.
Oh, firewalls?
That would do it every time. There goes the bell, and that means we must mark our ballots and decide whether we think it's number one or number two. Or number three. And if everybody has made up their minds and marked their ballots, we'll start the voting with Kitty Carlisle, please.
Well, I really don't. Number two said it was a physics professor that started him off. Number one said it was a language professor. And the language professor he mentioned sounded as though he had an Italian name, so I voted for number one.
All right, I got one showing. And Tom, are you going to play?
I am. I wonder if in years to come that we will think the modern weapons of war are sort of cute and kind of fun. I voted for number one because he seemed to know what he was talking about when he was talking about these engines of destruction.
Pair of ones, Peg.
Well, I voted for number two because anybody who knows about Archimedes can't be all bad.
And Bill Cullen, what are you going to do?
Well, it was I who said it was a language professor, not he. But anyway,
He
did come up with a name that sounded familiar to me, and I think he was a language professor. Latin, I hope. For that reason, I voted two also.
Everybody but Peggy is... you said you voted for two, but you put down a one, Bill, so you're stuck with what
I
you
voted
put
for what? No, I said I, too, voted for one.
Oh, I'm sorry, voted for one.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. And so let's see what's happened with the three of them over there. Will the real David Dorch please stand up? Yep, there you go. Very fine, David. Thank you very much. Now, number two, would you tell us what your name is, please, and what you do?
My name is Mark Fisher. I'm a senior at Rhodes School in New York City.
And number three, tell us about yourself.
My name is Fred Von Stange. I'm a junior at Huntington High School in New York.
Hi. David, did you go in for this because you're interested in history or because you're interested in mechanics? And
well, I went into it because of the mechanics involved.
That's what I thought. He was snooping around the control room, wanting to know how everything worked. He has a very inquiring mind, indeed. I meant snooping, David, in the very best sense. You understand that.
Was there anyone in there who could tell him?
Turned out, no. David Dorch and friends, thank you very much for being with us on To Tell the Truth. Tom Poston, may I say it is always a joy to have you with us.
Yes. How nice to be here. Thank you.
And I hope you keep it that way in the future. And we're all enough of this necking you two. It's time for us to knock it off, and thank you all very, very much for giving us a good time.
Our central characters today will receive cameo Sherback curtains of Celanese Fortrell. You just pull the tape for a perfect break. Machine wash, and they're beautiful. Promotional consideration provided by Best Western Motels, the nation's largest chain of 1,200 fine owner-operated motels in 900 cities from coast to coast. Roman Holiday Film, courtesy of WSBT-TV, South Bend, Indiana. This is Johnny Olson speaking for To Tell the Truth. Amar Goodson, Bill Todman, put up.
On Game Show Network.
Ladies and gentlemen, from New York City, Joe Garagiola.
Thank you.
Just going to stand here and really soak it in. Thank you very much. Thank you, Bill Wendell. And I want to welcome you to a most interesting edition of To Tell the Truth. First off today, we have one of the stars of a new off-Broadway musical. But there's a twist to this story, and I got to tell you, that's got to be the understatement of the year, and that's really put it mildly. We're going to go into this story, but first, let's meet our panel, and here they come. Bill Cullen. Peggy Cash. Gene Shalit. And Gritty Carlisle. Listen, I wouldn't want you to get the wrong impression. Peggy just had a manicure, and she said, don't touch me, and I won't touch you. So that's the reason for it, see? Okay.
No!
Now, panel, currently in New York, there's an off-Broadway musical, and it's called The Club. And in it, women play the parts of men. I want you to meet two of the cast members now with Memory Inerarity at the piano. What a nice name, Memory Inerarity. Joanne Beretta is singing the lyrics. Here's how the females in The Club think males look and sound like. Here they come.
To Sissy was like the Venus de Milo. Beautiful, but not all there. Oh, what blissy when we kissy. Stars like radium shine. Sissy, Sissy, tell me the sea. Mine, mine, mine.
Okay, that's Joanne Beretta singing, and Memory Inerarity is at the piano. Now, you got to believe me, honest to goodness woman. And now the all-female cast of The Club consists of seven talented young ladies, and you're going to meet another member of The Club right now.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Gloria Holtz.
Number two.
My name is Gloria Holtz.
Number three.
My name is Gloria Holtz.
Okay, panel, it's your job to try to find out who is the real Gloria Holtz. And here is the story. I, Gloria Holtz, play the role of a cigar-smoking, swaggering man in the off-Broadway musical, The Club. In fact, all the performers in this musical diversion are women playing men. Set in a men's club in 1903, four Victorian gentlemen are spending an evening at their club. They sing sexist songs and they tell sexist jokes. In one scene, I actually play a woman playing a man who is in turn playing a woman. All this is quite in contrast to my previous stage career. You see, last year, I made my singing debut with the Metropolitan Opera. Signed, Gloria Holtz. You don't think our panel's going to have some fun with this? I'll tell you what, you come right back in just a couple of minutes. Okay, panel, across the way, we have three women, all claiming to be Gloria Holtz, who plays the part of a man in the off-Broadway musical, The Club. And incidentally, later on, Gloria and Joanne Beretta, whom you met earlier, they'll perform another number from the show. But right now, we get started with the questioning, and let's go to Gene Shalit.
Thank you, Joseph. Number one, when you took this part, what was the most difficult aspect of the masculine gender that you found it to imitate? What was there about men that was hard to capture on stage?
People asking me what was most difficult.
Very good. Number two, should a man offer a woman a cigar? Do you mind smoking cigars in the show? Do you smoke cigars in the show?
Yes.
Number two, I beg your pardon. I thought I said number two.
You did.
You do smoke cigars in the show. Do you enjoy smoking cigars in the show?
Not particularly.
Number three, when you're off camera, do you ever dress as a man? Did you ever like to wear slacks and jackets and ties? A lot of girls do these days, it seems to me.
Sure, and three-piece suits.
Do you like that?
Not as a steady diet, but yeah.
Do you like your haircut as a steady diet?
Before I start stepping on it, yeah.
Number two, when you sang in the Met, was last year your first year in the Metropolitan Opera?
Yes.
How did you come to...
Whoops, we'll never get the answer to that. Let's ask Kitty.
Yes, well, I'd like to ask number two, what happened to your operatic career? Have you abandoned it?
Not at all. I just need to make a living.
Well, number one, were you hired for the chorus or were you hired as a featured singer?
No, I was featured in De Valkyrie.
Uh-huh. And number one, I see you have a beard. Is that yours or is it...
Oh, well, no, it's 5 o'clock shadow. I forgot to shave.
Number three, I'd like to find out a little bit more about the club. What is the point of the performance? I mean, does it have a kind of a thesis? What is it? I'm at sea a little bit.
It does. It's set in 1903, and I think the whole point is to show that things really haven't changed so much on the women's lib front.
I see.
It's kind of an... It's not camp. It's very sophisticated.
Thank you. Is it, number one, is it like a vaudeville show? Do you all do separate turns, or does it have a story?
In a way, it's set in a 1903 men's club, and they're telling sexist jokes and talking about
it. Number two, you all are
not... Whoops, the buzzer. And before I ask Bill Cullen, can I ask you to speak up like the men you're playing and really boom it out? I'm getting a little old, and I'm losing my hearing, too. Bill?
Number two, in opera, there are many parts in opera that women play, parts of men. Is that not so?
Yes.
Have you played any of those?
Yes.
What number three is the most prominent one, the one we know best, those who are not opera buffs, where a girl plays the part of a young boy or a young man?
Prince Olofsky.
Number one, your hair has been cut for this role. Am I right there?
No, it was quite short. It wasn't quite this short, but it was short.
And number two, how about you? Has your hair been cut?
It was short, but not this short.
What is described to me, although you cannot tell one, I know, but describe to me what a sexist joke is, number two.
That is very difficult. I'm sorry, I don't think I can.
Well, would it be like what we call dirty jokes?
Put down jokes.
Putting down the women?
Yes.
Okay.
Let's go to Peggy.
Thank you. Number three, it says, I actually play a woman playing a man who is in turn playing a woman. That sounds like the infinity of mirrors. What do you wear when you're doing this number?
It's a play that's going on in the club, and I tie a cape around my waist.
Oh, around your waist?
Yes.
Oh, so you'll be a woman?
Right.
But you're really a guy in drag?
Right.
Right, okay. Now, number two, how many people are in the show?
Seven.
Thank you. And number one, who directed it?
Ted Mann.
Well, weren't you really terribly dependent on a director in a show like this? He must have really had to do some job.
Quite a bit, yes. Getting the characters.
Thank you. Number two, who wrote the music and lyrics, or do you use old numbers?
We use old numbers, turn-of-the-century numbers.
Well, but number three, you must have a book that threads it together, or is it just set pieces?
No, you mean originally there was a book. Originally there was a script, a play script written.
What did you do, throw it out? Or do you still have the play script?
We still have the script.
Oh, I see what you mean.
Well, that means that our game is over. Now it's time to vote and it's time to make a decision. Our panel makes it. You'll have a chance. Do you think it's number one? Is it number two? Or is it number three? Now, we pay $50 for each wrong answer, $500 if our challengers stump our panel. And Gene Shalit, everybody has voted. You started it. How did you vote?
I have not yet seen the club, so I'm not going to disqualify myself because I don't know who it is. Okay? That's for openers.
Okay.
The next thing is, I like the way number one pronounced the German when she spoke with the Wagnerian opera she was in, and that's the only thing I've got to go on. They're all good. I'm going to vote for number one.
Number one. How about you, Kitty?
Well, that's true. Number one was very good in that respect, but the only one that looks like a singer to me is number two, so I voted for number two.
Number two. All right. Bill Cullen.
Very few people who watch this show regularly realize that this panel is actually composed of three men and one lady.
Three men and one
lady.
Gee, Kitty, I never knew.
I'm not going to tell. Wild horses will not drag the answer from me.
But I'll never tell her.
No. I voted for number two.
Okay. And let's go to Sweet Peggy Cass to get her vote.
Thank you. Well, I think number two looks like a singer. I really do. And number one, they really spent a lot of time doing your makeup, but there's something about number three and the way she talked about the book that made me think it was she.
Number three.
Oh, everybody's got a vote.
All right, everybody has a vote. Now we'll find out. Will the real Gloria Hodes please stand up? Gloria, while you get set backstage, I know you're going to fill this stage with a lot of song. We'll find out who your imposters are. Number one, what is your name and what do you do?
My name is Mary Van Brunt, and I'm a maitre d' here in New York at Privé. It's a new supper club on First Avenue.
Oh. And number three, what is your name and what do you do?
My name is Pat Van Kirk. I'm a copywriter for Needham & Grohman Advertising and Rockefeller Center.
Okay, and now, accompanied by Maestro Memory Interarity, Gloria Hodes and Joanne Beretta will sing a number from the show called A Woman is Only a Woman, but a Good Cigar is a Smoke. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, here they are. Is an authority on an endangered species, and it's not a Siberian tiger, and it's not the American bald eagle either. I'll tell you that. You stay tuned for 2 minutes, and we will tell you what that endangered species is. Now let's meet a man who is really concerned about the fate of an endangered species.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Herb Goldberg.
Number two.
My name is Herb Goldberg.
Number three.
My name is Herb Goldberg.
Listen now to Herb Goldberg's plea. I, Herb Goldberg, am a psychology professor. It is my contention that the American male is an endangered species. It is high time for men to get liberated from traditional sex roles, from the macho syndrome, and from being half of the Women's Lib Act. Males face a whole series of conflicts. They're damned if they do and damned if they don't. They're destroying themselves emotionally, psychologically, and physically. I've written... Listen to them out there. I'm not even finished. I've written a book on the myth of masculine privilege. It's called The Hazards of Being Male. Signed, Herb Goldberg. Right on. Attaboy, Joe. You hear him out there? Kitty, do you think that the male is an endangered species?
Well, I'm glad you asked me, because I do think that men have had a lot of problems since Women's Lib.
Good.
It's unsettled them. It's made them not know which kind of a role to assume or which foot to dance on. Number three, what do you consider the major hazards of being a man today?
There are too many. I don't consider any major hazards. I think there are many hazards.
Can't you name me one important one?
Survival.
Uh-huh. Number two, do you feel that men have a right now, as has often been said, to cry and to show all the tender emotions and show that they too get hurt and they don't have to be so macho all the time?
Well, that's one of the points of the book, trying to show that men should express their true emotions and not have to repress them and continue to role play and withhold everything.
Yeah. Number one, do you also feel that this leads to a whole other kind of role in society, that men should be able to take care of the kids and stay home and do the cooking and the washing if they want to?
Absolutely. It's an honest role.
Right. Oh, I agree with you. I'm dying for somebody to do that
Let's
to me.
Let's go down to Bill Cullen.
For younger people, younger than I am, number one, I will address this to you. The sex act, which...
This is a family show.
Yes, the whole family act. No, not that. Who should be the aggressor sexually, number one?
There is no aggressor sexually. It's absolutely mutual.
You mean... Wait a minute now. Number three, do you go along with that? That it's mutual?
I don't know what you mean by mutual.
Well, which one tries to make the other one number three? To put it in my terms.
Whoever's more in the mood.
Yeah. Number two, should the man be the aggressor when it comes to, you know, like, let's go a neck or whatever they... That's what we did in our day. Before that, we spooned and we necked and then we got married.
You're dating yourself.
I am indeed, but which one should
Nobody
be the
else
aggressor?
Will.
Anymore. Assuming I'm... Thank you.
I'm in love. Poor Bill Cullen, guys. He's dated himself right out of it. Okay, Peggy, you want to pursue that line of questioning?
Bill, bail you up. Number two, you say that men are in danger, they're fighting for survival. But after all, we can't kill them off. We need them, or else the future of the human race is in doubt, right?
I missed part of what you said. That...
Well, I mean, we can't kill the men off. We need them, or else there won't be any babies.
Exactly.
Well, so you're not fighting for survival. We're going to let you live.
Well, read the book. The book is essentially a manual for male survival.
Well, number three, do you think that it is possible for a man and a woman to have an absolute equal partnership in all things?
Not the way things are right now, no.
But would that be your goal?
I think that would be ideal.
Yeah. Well, number one, when you said it's an honest role for a man to stay home and take care of the kids, and the woman goes out and does a hard day's work, now really, most men won't accept the role of staying home and having and taking care of the kids.
I didn't say that.
You said it was an honest role.
I said it was an honest role to share.
Oh, well, somebody has to stay home and take care of the
kids.
Well,
let's find out if Gene Shalit will stay home.
Never. I've been doing a good job. I've been staying home a long time. You say in your affidavit, you're number three, you're damned if you do and you're damned if you don't. If do or don't what?
Well, there's a chapter in my book called Impossible Binds, and I...
Binds?
Binds, B-I-N-D-S.
Thank you.
And I list about 20 major damned if you do, damned if you don't
situations. Can we have one?
Having to be... part of the discontinuity, for example, between early training, which teaches you not to be sensual or expressive, and then expecting the male to be exactly that when he gets married.
Number one, some people think that if a man cries, it's a sign of weakness. Senator Muskie wept and may have cost him the presidential election 5 years ago. Do you think it's a sign of weakness for a man to cry?
I think it's a sign of strength, that he has the courage to cry.
Number two...
That means that it's time to start voting. Our panel is going to do that. Is it number one? Is it number two? Is it number three? Sounds interesting up there. We'll pay $50 for each incorrect answer and $500 if they stump our panel completely. And Kitty, you started it. How did you vote?
Oh, yes. Well, I voted for number three. He again has that scientific turn of mind. He wouldn't tell me which was the most important hazard being a man today. So that's got to be he.
Okay, Bill Cullen.
Never having had any of those problems in my life, I never even bothered about this. But number two was the one who mentioned the book most frequently. He answered the questions with, well, buy the book and you'll see more than anybody else. And I figure that makes sense, so it must be number two.
Okay, the logic again gets me. How about you, Peggy?
You know, I once went to the movies with a guy. We saw Heidi, and he cried when Heidi had to go to visit the grandmother or something. And I never went out with him again. I don't want a guy crying at the movies. I voted for number three.
Listen, I cried at a hockey game. What's wrong with that?
What would you? That puck must have hit you in the mouth.
Uh-huh.
Beautiful, Gene.
I voted for number three because he said discontinuity, and I think only professors say discontinuity. Yeah.
Okay. So the votes are all in. Will the real Herb Goldberg please stand up? Let's find out who the imposters are. Number one, what is your name and what do you do?
My name is Mike Solomon, and I'm a vice president of MCA Television.
There you are. Number two, what is your name and what do you do?
In real life, my name is Richard Glazer. I'm the director of promotions for Walt Frazier Sports Enterprises in New York.
There you are. Okay, so... We thank you, Herb Goldberg, and your two imposters for playing our game to tell the truth. Thank you very much, gentlemen.
You're watching Game Show Network. Stay tuned for What's My Line, followed by Beat the Clock, then take a time out with Child's Play.
You may have heard it during the show. I know I did, but when Peggy was talking about the fellow who cried watching Heidi, Bill Cullen said, I cried watching Heidi. Did you really cry?
I and a lot of other men throughout the country about 3 years ago when NBC took the Jet Oakland football game off and put Heidi on. You remember that? I, to this day, am crying
You're
about
rotten.
That.
You're rotten! See you again. So long, everybody.
In addition to the cash awards, our first team of challenges will receive Sarah Coventry, exclusive fashion jewelry that you can buy from a friend. Sarah Coventry, the jewelry with know-how. Our second team will receive Good Wax, the world's largest selling liquid car wax. Cleans, polishes, protects, and one easy operation. Good Wax with a hard shell finish. This is Bill Wendell speaking for To Tell the Truth, a Mark Goodson, Bill Totman production.
Network.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is John Preston.
Number two.
My name is John Preston.
Number three.
My name is John Preston.
Only one of these people is the real John Preston and has sworn to tell the truth. Studio 6A, New York's Rockefeller Center. Let's meet our panel. First, poet and master comedian, Nipsey Russell. Star of The Elephant Man on Broadway, Carol Shelley. Acclaimed by critics across the nation for his brilliant nightclub act, Soupy Sales. And writer, businesswoman, and recording star, Polly Bergen. Here's the host of To Tell the Truth, Robin Wolf.
Hey, come on. Who's six? There's a good dog. Isn't that a great dog? It's a well-trained dog. This beautiful dog is called Harass the Second. And not only is he good to look at, he's also worth over $20,000 if he was for sale. This is an absolutely brilliantly trained tracking dog. He can find explosives or drugs. So if you got any on you, you just better put him aside, because he'll find you. So right now, let's find her, his handler. He's a strong little devil, I'm telling you that. You want to come out and take Harass, please, before he takes me right off the stage? Let's hear it for Harass the Second. He's a beautiful dog, eh? Thank you very much. We'll see you after.
That's a lot of
dog.
You thought I was bringing... Please have a sale. Please do. Forgive me. I didn't know you were staying on my... You thought that dog... I was bringing that dog out, didn't you? That dog was bringing me out. You do what Hero says. You'll find out what this is all about if you would open your envelopes and follow along as I read about all this. I, John Preston, own a kennel where I import and train dogs for use in police and detective work. I have two animals that can sniff out illegal drugs, find explosives, and are also used for tracking purposes. Harass the Second, whom you've already met, is my prize tracker. Thanks to his sensitive nose, he has saved at least four lives and has a 100% conviction rate against suspects whose scents he's identified. As a result, Harass the Second is qualified as an expert in the courts of 14 states and 5 federal districts. In more than 300 cases, Harass the Second has failed less than 10 times to get his man, woman, or child. Signed, John Preston. And welcome, gentlemen. It's good to have you on the show. And panel, these three gentlemen all claim to be dog trainer and handler of John Preston. And let's start the questioning with Nipsey.
Number three, is this particular breed especially adaptable for the kinds of work that you just outlined in your affidavit?
Yes.
Can you tell me what the characteristic is in that animal that makes him more so than other breeds used for this kind of work?
Three. No, he has to have a good nose.
I see. Number one, what do you use as a lead to give the animal the scent with which he identifies in tracking?
It depends on what you're after. If it's in drugs, you use one of the drugs you're after. If it's an article of clothing, then something that's been worn.
Okay, thank you. Number two, suppose he's tracking an individual. How do you first give him the familiarity to follow?
From the scent on whatever article.
Suppose you have no scent from the item.
And we go to Carol Shelley.
I know this sounds like a silly question, and it is. Why don't the dogs get high sniffing from cocaine or something like that? Do they? Number two.
No.
Why not? I'm really serious. I mean, if you're training a dog to smell out certain things, why doesn't it affect them?
Once he's identified the particular item, the drug, cocaine, or hashish, or marijuana, then he lets us know and we take him
away. I understand
away.
That, but why doesn't he keel over with a silly smile on his face?
No, it just doesn't happen.
And is that true, number one?
Well, you don't let him be exposed to it that much.
I see.
And we go to Soupy.
Thank you. Number one, do you belong to a particular police force, or do you work freelance?
Freelance.
Number two, where do you work out of?
Out of my home kennel.
And where is that?
Over in Jersey.
Uh-huh. Number three, when they call you, do you set a price for them or what? Do they work? The dog work by the hour or what? By the sniff?
It's a set price.
It's a set price? Number one, when you have brought in the conviction, is the dog in court with you to help identify him? Or
he's credited with being an expert witness.
Uh-huh. No.
And we go to Polly.
How do you get a dog to swear they're telling the truth and nothing but the truth?
You're asking me?
On the Bible, I guess.
Get Rob in there.
Number two, do you agree with number three that particular type of dog is the best dog for this kind of work?
Yes, they're very highly trained, West Germany.
I see. And number one, does that kind of a dog have a better nose than another kind of dog?
Believe it or not, all dogs have a nose that's near equal. It's the training, and once you have a dog, you wouldn't want a small dog to be a tracker. Once you found the suspect, if they want to elude pursuit or fight back,
a cocker spaniel would be hard put to get away.
No.
I see.
Ringing the bell, panel. That means your time is up, and you must come to a decision and vote for number one, for number two, or for number three. Said Nipsey, who did you vote for?
I voted for number two because, for the simple reason, number one and three say, and they may be right, that this particular breed is good for that. But most of the tracking of humans that I've read, heard, and seen about uses bloodhounds, not German shepherds.
Okay. Carol, who got your vote?
Number one got my vote, because he took my question seriously.
Soupy, who got your vote?
Well, I noticed that you had trouble handling him. when you brought that dog
strong.
Out.
He's strong.
And number two, all three were great, could be either one, but number two is sort of big, and I could understand where you'd need somebody like that to take care of that dog or have him eaten right out of his leg. And no time. I vote for number two.
Okay, Polly, who did you vote?
Carol, I don't think you should feel silly about that question at all. I thought Harass the Second had a slight silly grin on his face anyway.
That's right.
I vote
Thank
for
you.
Number two for no other reason but that I couldn't figure out who to vote for.
All right, now we're going to find out which of these gentlemen is in fact the real John Preston. And who better to pick out the real John Preston or to sniff him out than Harass the Second
don't
himself?
Let that dog loose.
Here he comes.
Oh, I'm just so silly.
There it is. That's love. That's love. Let's find out who our imposters are. Number one, you got yourself a vote. Would you tell us, please, who you are and what you do?
I'm Larry Cannon. I have the finest hairstyling shop in the whole United States.
Really?
And it's in Danville, Illinois.
Yeah. Great. Thank you very much. And number two, you got yourself three votes. Can you tell us a little bit about yourself, please?
I'm Roger White from Haledon, New Jersey, and I'm an orthodontist with an office in Hawthorne, New Jersey.
And that means you're very rich, doesn't it, of course? You're an orthodontist. John, what happens if Harass gets a cold? Are you out of business, kind of thing? If he gets the hay fever or a little sniffles, does that diminish his ability to track?
I have never had an occasion in the 3 years I've worked with this dog for him to be incapacitated by a cold. I had him stick his nose in one of the other kennels one day.
I'll bet.
And received 9 stitches in it. Oh. And the next morning, they called me for a double homicide in Atlanta, Georgia. And I called the vet and said, what do I do? And he said, well, I suggest you take him. It'll get his mind off from how much his nose hurts. We tracked and identified the two suspects in that murder and then went to Kissimmee, Florida, on a kidnapping murder of a postmistress, in which the dog tracked and identified that murder suspect also.
Thank you. Well, you have done it. You have fooled our panel. There were 4 incorrect votes. You have therefore won the jackpot of $500. I hope you buy some nice big bone for Harass or something. What does he like to eat? Steak?
Anyone. Harass is poison proofed. He only eats his dog food once a day.
I see. Well, it's marvelous having you on the show. Thank you for joining us on To Tell the Truth, gentlemen. We'll see you on One on One. And we'll be coming back, so stay where you are.
Yeah, it's called Wheel 2000, and it's the bomb.
So it's like Wheel of Fortune, right?
Yeah, it's a family version with pulling and slamming games.
Can I buy a vowel?
Sure, we're family. I'll give you 250 points credit this time.
How about an E?
Yeah, we got two. Yeah.
Is it Game Show Network?
Yeah, you win because Wheel 2000 starts this fall on Game Show Network. Yeah.
Robin? We are back, and let's meet our next team of challengers.
All right.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Letty Cotton Pulgribbin.
Number two.
My name is Letty Cotton Pulgribbin.
And number three.
My name is Letty Cotton Pulgribbin.
All right, panel, once again, would you open your envelopes, please, and follow along with me as I read this affidavit.
All right.
I, Letty Cotton Pogrebin, believe strongly in non-sexist child raising. The American preoccupation with femininity and masculinity serves to thwart our children's innate gifts and abilities. I believe that most parents unwittingly practice a form of sex discrimination which the schools help to perpetuate. I felt that my twin daughter should learn touch football as well as sewing, and that my son should be given the chance to play with dolls as well as with trucks. In that way, kids can develop as unique individuals and not be molded into stereotypes of their sex. I have written a book on raising your child in the 80s titled Growing Up Free, signed Letty Cotton Pogrebin.
Thank you.
And welcome. It's nice to have you on the show. And panel, these three ladies all claim to be the author of Growing Up Free, Letty Cotton Pogrebin. Let's start the questioning with Polly.
Number one, are you married?
Yes, I am.
I see. Do you have children?
Three.
Right. Do you believe also that you and your husband must set certain standards as well in terms of your actions in front of the children?
Certainly.
Number two, do you find that it is easy to train a husband to do that?
Well, I didn't really have to train my husband very much. He was very receptive to my feminist viewpoint.
I see. Number three, what does androgyny mean?
Androgyny means two different parts of one person, masculine and feminine.
I see. Number one, do you have difficulty getting the schools to go along with your point of view?
Of course. Schools are a part of the establishment. They resist change.
I see.
And we go to Nipsey.
Number one, do you believe there are any roles for which a female of a given species is designed by nature?
Wet nurse.
What do you mean by wet nurse?
That's the only role that is specific to sex that I can think of.
All right. Number three, whether you believe in Darwinism or divine creation of the universe, other species have set roles. Males and females have certain things that they do. You don't believe that's true of the human species?
No, I don't. I really believe that most of the things that we do in our lives are set by our own sexual stereotypes.
Do you know, number two then, do you believe that there are certain things for which the feminine form is better designed than the masculine form of the same species?
Well, in humans, of course, females give
birth. In other words, you think a woman...
Males cannot give birth.
And
but
we go to Carol Shelley.
But do you want your daughter to grow up to be... to be a woman, your son to grow up to be a man, does it worry you that possibly by playing with dolls and reversing certain game areas that this may have an adverse effect on them?
Actually, it really doesn't, because what I really want my children to grow up to be is free to choose whatever behavior they find is really them.
Natural to them. Natural. Do you agree with that, number one?
I do.
Number two, how do your children react to this? Were they easy to accept your choices for them?
Well, they didn't really...
Does that make sense? Do you know what I mean?
I know what you mean, but it wasn't a question of accepting my choices for them. You see, one of the things about sexism is that it really is unfair. And children have a much greater sense of fairness than adults. So they knew instinctively what was fair.
And we go to Soupy.
Number one, you mentioned about the girls playing football and the boy playing with a doll. Is that something they wanted to do or something you forced them to do?
You expose them to lots of options and give them the choice.
Number two, did your daughters want to play football?
Well, it happens that my daughters have better athletic skills than my son does.
Number three, did he want to play with a doll, or did you say, hey, you, or what? Did he see his sisters playing with a doll?
Since he was the youngest, yes, he was exposed to playing with dolls because his sister was playing with dolls as well. And what I did is I just encouraged him to play with whatever he wanted to play with.
Yeah, well, number one, is that not sort of...
Ringing that bell. That means your time is up, panel, and you must now vote for number one... For number two, or for number three, whoever you think is the real Letty Cotton Pogrebin. And, panel, if the ballots are all marked, Polly, who got your vote?
Well, all three of them are really good. They've done their homework well, and the people in the back have really cued them in very well. I, for no other reason than just a sort of a wild stab in the dark, voted for number one. I agree very much with what they have to say and what their feelings are. I think that there is no difference... in terms of play, and children should be given freedom of choice to do whatever it is they want to do. They're very bright. They'll work it out okay.
Okay. Nipsey, who got your vote?
Well, there are many criteria applied in selecting choices on this game, I found. This time I discarded the information, and I tried to judge by attitude. Number one seems deadly serious about this whole discussion, whereas the other two took it kind of lightheartedly, so I was number one.
And Carol?
Very, very difficult, because all three, unless they're really very good actresses, seem to be very convincing about, but I have voted for number three.
All right. And Soupy, who'd you vote for?
Well, I like boys to be boys and girls to be girls, until someone comes up with a better arrangement.
still be a boy and be a girl. Playing touch football and dolls doesn't make a man or a girl a girl.
You want to wrestle?
Anytime you say,
let's watch this. sounds good.
All right.
Well, I don't want to get in a big fight. Or like
just pick up.
That's right. Number one was very emphatic about the being a wet nurse and everything, and she's, I think that's it.
All right, the votes are all in, and now we're going to find out which of these ladies has very definite opinions on how to raise children in the 80s. With a reel, Letty Cotton Pogrebin, please stand up. Find out who our imposters are, first of all, before we have a hand for the little lady. Number two, could you tell us a little bit about yourself, please?
Yes, my name is Phyllis Rich Flood. I live here in New York, and I'm head of a company called Pushpanoff Incredible Edibles. And we design and manufacture beautiful candies and delicious things to eat.
All right. Great. And number three, Carol Shelley fell for your particular line.
Yeah.
Would you tell us who you are, please, and
what
you do?
My name is Kathleen Williams, and I'm a management consultant.
In New York here?
I'm convincing.
Great. Nice to have you. We have to cut this discussion in the bud. We are totally out of time. Hey, there was one incorrect vote. You won $100. Ladies, thank you for joining us on To Tell the Truth. We'll see Judy on One-on-One. Thank you. We'll be right back, so don't go away. We are back, and we're going to play One-on-One. Yes, we are.
She wants to pass any other spot yet.
Panel, you of course remember these four people. They were all very good imposters on the first two spots in the show. Now you do know a few things about them. We've chatted with them. There's one fact you don't know.
Yes.
One of these four people, if you look down at the monitor, you're going to see a piece of film.
Okay, wait a minute.
One of these four people is actually driving the car. Panel, it's up to you to find out which of these people was driving that rather hot-looking machine. And Polly, if you're ready to question Larry, please start.
Larry, what kind of car was that?
That was an Indianapolis car.
You mean you drove in the Indianapolis 500?
Well, sure.
You did?
Yeah.
You wouldn't lie to a person, would you?
Now, Polly, would I do that to you just because you're beautiful?
Oh, thank you, Larry. It's him. I don't have to ask anymore. It's him.
That's a yes for Larry. And Soupy, if you're ready to question Roger, please proceed.
Roger, is that taken at the Indianapolis Speedway?
No, that's in Ontario, California.
Oh, I knew that.
Uh-huh. And whereabouts is Ontario Raceway?
Around Los Angeles,
uh-huh.
California.
And how long have you been racing?
Oh, about 15 years.
Uh-huh. And... how many members in your pit crew?
About eight.
Do you own the car?
Is Roger our racing car driver?
No.
Yes or no? It's a no for Roger. And Carol, if you're ready to interrogate Phyllis, hit it.
Yes. Phyllis, how long have you been racing?
4 years.
What car did you start out with?
In a Ferrari.
A Ferrari?
Ferrari Sports.
Ferrari Sports. Mm-hmm. On what track?
In Bridgehampton and in Limerick, in Connecticut.
What is a racing gear change? How do you do a racing gear change?
I don't do the gear change.
What do you mean?
Is Phyllis our race car driver? Yes
no.
or no? That's a no for Phyllis. And Nipsey, if you're ready to question Kathleen, start now.
Kathleen, how do you stop that car other than with the brakes?
Well, you downshift.
Do you have a stick shift or is it an automatic transmission?
No, it's a stick shift.
Why is there no tread on those tires?
I'm not sure.
Why is there no tread on any of it?
Is Kathleen our race car driver? Yes or no?
Well, I'll have to say yes.
All right, yes for Kathleen. The decisions have been made, and now it's time for the truth. Will the real professional race car driver please stand up?
Downshift, she says.
Good.
He has good taste as well.
There was one incorrect vote.
I'm
you
glad
won.
That was $100. Cars.
$100. Thank you for joining us on One-on-One. Thanks so much, Larry. Good luck. And we'll be right back. So stay where you are.
Watch Game Show Network. Your life may depend on it.
watching Game Show Network. Don't miss To Tell the Truth, followed by Game World Weekend. Then get ready for our quadruple feature, The Password 4.
Robin. Panel, I have to say goodbye. I thank you for being here. It's been a pleasure for me. See you next time on To Tell the Truth.
Speaking for To Tell the Truth, the Mark Goodson, Bill Chapman production.
It's time to register to play our live interactive game shows. Call 800-537-GAME now. It's fast, it's fun, and it's free. You only have to register once to play forever on Game Show Network.
This man is a mugger. This portrait was painted by his victim, who is one of these three men. Number one, what is your name, please?
Ralph Wolf Cowan.
Number two.
My name is Ralph Wolf Cowan.
Number three.
My name is Ralph Wolf Cowan.
Only one of these people is the real Ralph Wolf Cowan, and is the only one sworn to tell the truth. Now, let's meet our panel. Host of Let's Make a Deal, Monty Hall. Star of Mama's Family, Vicki Lawrence Schultz. Film and television producer, David Niven Jr. And temporarily unable to make her usual grand entrance, our very own Kitty Carmile. Host of To Tell the Truth, Lynn Swann.
Yay! We're back. Whoa, I love it. I love it. Hello, everyone. Having a good time? All right. Good morning, panel.
Hello.
Good morning, Lynn.
Yes, everyone's, everyone's having a good time here?
Yeah.
Terrific, terrific.
Good.
Well, let's get right to the story presented by our first team of challengers, all three of whom claim to be Ralph Wolf Cowan. And here is his story. Please, read along with me. I, Ralph Wolf Cowan, paint portraits of the rich and famous. One of my first portraits emerged from a dream about Princess Grace. It was so real, I actually painted the portrait. When Prince Rainier saw it, he was so impressed, he named me his royal portrait artist. Later, I was commissioned to paint the royal family while I stayed at the palace in Monaco. Through Princess Grace, I met Imelda Marcos, who introduced me to many celebrated figures. As a result, I've done portraits of Pope John Paul II and Nancy Reagan. I'm also the only artist for whom Elvis Presley ever sat. And here is a portrait that doesn't fit into the pattern of my exclusive clientele. This scrawny fellow in modest shorts and dirty sneakers is a guy who mugged me in a dark parking lot. Overnight, I sketched the thief's face. The next morning, I expanded it into a full portrait in oils, which the police copied for the wanted posters. I hope he's caught and then convicted. He's already been framed. Signed, Ralph Wolf Cowan. We'll find out more about this painter who captured his mugger on canvas right after this. Okay, panel. These three people all claim to be Ralph Wolf Cowan, who paints portraits of the famous and call them mugger on canvas. Let's start the questioning with you, Kitty.
Thank you. Number one, how long ago were you mugged, and how long has that thing been circulating, that portrait?
Well, it's about a year.
And you haven't had any luck yet? He hasn't been really caught?
Probably back in Haiti.
Number two, where did Prince Rainier see this portrait? How did he find it, that you did of Princess Grace?
The first one?
The one you did in the dream. How did he see it?
Oh, I sent a photograph of it to his press agent, and that afternoon he brought Prince Rainier up, and he liked it and loved it.
In New York?
In New York.
And number three, where did you paint Elvis Presley?
That was in Caesar's Palace in Las Vegas.
How long ago?
1969.
Okay, thank you. Move on down to David Niven Jr.
Thank you. Number one, when you painted Princess Grace and the rest of the royal family, where did you stay in the palace?
Oh, I stayed in the garden.
In a tent?
No, in a small house in the garden.
Ah,
Thank you very much.
Number two, when Mrs. Marcus introduced you to many celebrities, did she introduce you to George Hamilton and a few others?
Yes.
Who were the others?
The King of Morocco, the King of Saudi Arabia, and put me in the same room with the Pope.
Very good. Number three, when you met the Pope, how did you refer to him?
Your Holiness, it was at an apostolic delegation in Washington, D.C.
And was he obedient?
David, thank you. Vicky.
Number one, how long does it take you to do a portrait?
Roughly 2 weeks.
And number two, where do you do your work?
In my studio in West Palm Beach.
And number three, do you do a lot of work from memory?
Well, I do. I have a photographic memory, but mostly I do them from photographs.
You have a photographic memory?
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, my goodness.
Vicky, thank you.
Well, you're
Monty.
Welcome, Lynn.
Number two, who was the toughest one to paint?
I'd never say that in a million years.
All right, then answer this question, number two. When the Pope was posing for you, did he talk to you?
He was talking always as sort of the royal we.
And number one, did you when you painted Nancy Reagan, was she conversant at all, or did she sit quietly?
Reasonably.
All right. Number three, I'm going to ask you, who was the hardest one to paint?
There's no one that I could name, honestly.
Mm-hmm. Monty, thank you. They didn't want to give you the answers you were looking for.
These are the toughest ones to answer.
That's correct. Well, the time is up. Time to vote for either number one.
No, you didn't.
Number two, or number three. Our team of challengers will receive $500 for each incorrect vote with a guarantee of $1,000. And if the panel is completely fooled, the team will receive $3,000. So, panel, if you're ready to cast your ballots, Kitty?
It's hard. Oh, yeah, I'm ready. Yes. I thought number three was awfully young to have painted Elvis at probably 20 years ago. He doesn't look more than 40. Number one is made up to look like a real painter. And number two, he lived in the garden. I don't think he lived in the garden, in the palace. And I didn't believe number two, so I voted for number three.
Service is probably hard to get in the garden. Yes. David.
Well, I got confused by number one because when he said he lived in the house in the garden, I can't remember, having been there a number of times, I can't remember where that house would be, so that threw me off.
Oh, having been
name dropping.
There, yes.
And number two looks like he has three emblems. That's to fool us.
Yes.
But because he has three emblems, I voted for him, and I didn't believe number three. I'm sorry to tell you.
Vicki Lawrence.
Well, I know Mr. Ralph, and he's a charming, delightful guy, and I'll say hi to him later, but for now I'll disqualify myself.
Oh, okay. Monty Hall.
Well, I vote for number one as the Schweppes man, but not for Ralph Wolf Collin. Now, for Ralph Wolf Collin, I'm going to go to the man who said one answer that was intrigued me. He says, I wouldn't tell you what they said. And that's sort of an honest, confidential attitude to take. So I'll vote for number two.
Okay. A disqualification counts as an incorrect vote. And we see that number one doesn't have a vote. Number two has two votes. And number three, a single ballot. So this is now the moment of truth, gentlemen. Will the real Ralph Wolf Collin please stand up?
Yeah.
It is number two. Very, very good. Ralph, we'll get back to you in just a moment. Let's find out about your imposters. Number one, your name and what do you do?
My name is Alec Diltz. I was a retired senior marketing analyst for Douglas Aircraft Corporation.
Oh. Terrific. Number three, your name and what do you do?
My name is Bill Boulderbeck, and I'm in the dry cleaning business in the suburbs of Chicago.
Wonderful. Well, with the disqualification, that's two incorrect votes. Your team will receive $1,000. Now, Ralph, how long did it take you to sketch this mugger?
I did that in about 2 hours.
Yeah. Number three said he had a photographic memory. Do you have a photographic memory?
Yes, I only saw him for a split second while he was grabbing my chain.
Uh-huh. Boy, And you really do not have any idea where this man is at the moment.
No, but I'm when I finish it, I want to put bars in front of it. Vicky, we have to stop meeting like this.
Okay, well, thank you very much for being here on To Tell the Truth. Now, remember, if you see this man, call the West Palm Beach, Florida police at 407-847-4000 and don't show him your jewelry, okay? We'll be back for the lady who bats, for the lady whose bats about rats right after this. I get nervous when we talk about rats. I don't like it. We're back on To Tell the Truth, so let's meet our next team of challengers.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Leona Pasley.
Number two.
My name is Leona Pasley.
Number three.
My name is Leona Pasley.
And panel, it is up to you to locate the real Leona Pasley, and here is her story. Please, read along with me. I, Leona Pasley, love rats. I'm president of the American Fancy Rat and Mouse Association. We devote ourselves to breeding and exhibiting mice and rats. Not the usual low-class kind, but high-class rodents such as these. Polka-dotted mice, chocolate and Siamese mice, rare white mice with large Mickey Mouse ears, and adorable hairless mice. I think mice are nice, but I'm really bats about rats. Rats have been pets since the 1700s, but they've been given a bad rap. They didn't cause the 14th century plague. Here's a white mother rat with her 13 newborn kittens. And here are Siamese and cinnamon rats, an odd-eyed rat, and a jumbo agouti. Oh my goodness, he's out. In my home, I'm so nervous. In my home, my rats and mice live with my cat and dog. Incidentally, the dog is afraid of rats. Visitors are not surprised to see mice playing on my kitchen table, and no one except for me, Lynn Swan, goes eek or jumps on the chair. Signed, Leona Pasley. Okay, let's start the questioning with Monty Hall. You go ahead, go ahead.
My first question is who's going to catch the rat?
Ahead. Go ahead, Monty, start.
You catch the rat first.
I'll catch the dirty rat, you go ahead.
All right, number one, what's the difference between a high-class rat and a low-class rat?
Well, I only like high-class rats, but the low-class is a Rattus rattus, and a high-class is a Rattus norvaginus.
Oh, just by the genus and the species, do we know the difference? Number two, do the rats bite humans?
Occasionally, but these rats, as a general rule, don't bite.
Go ahead, Monty.
And number three, do rats eat shoes? Because what I was going to do it in just a moment.
Monty, thank you very much. Vicky.
Whoosh, get some odor eaters left. I didn't even hear a thing you asked. Number one, how do rodents do it?
How do rodents do it?
Uh-huh.
You've never watched two rodents? The same way as cats do it. Birds do it, bees do it.
Why don't we do it?
Now, number two, are they like housebreakable, house trainable?
No.
Well, but now number three, you said you let them run around your house.
Well,
do they make little things on your tables and you have to clean up after them?
Well, rats are very clean, and if their atmosphere is clean, and you clean up after your dog.
Yeah, too. But number one, where do they go? Do they know where to go?
Thank you. David, please.
The rat is a... number one, where do you exhibit your mice and rats?
We have six shows a year, every 2 months, in the Maryland, Virginia, Washington, D.C., Delaware area.
Thank you. Number two, when you attend these things, is there not a cat show somewhere nearby, is there by chance?
We try to schedule them very far apart.
You don't blame me. All right, now...
What? Thank you, David. Kidding.
Number three, you say that your
your mice live with cats and dogs. How is that possible? That is not according to nature.
Oh, yes, the dogs are afraid of the rats.
Yeah, but what about the cat?
Well, I keep the cats away from me.
Oh, so they don't really get together?
No.
And number two, what do you do with these? Are they for just for show?
Show, and then we breed them for pets.
Number one, I know...
Kitty, thank you. Thank you so much. Time is up.
The rat took my time.
Rats are upstaging everybody here today. So it's time to vote for either number one, number two, or number three, okay? We'll start. Monty, go ahead. Hurry, please.
Well, I think my vote goes to you, Lynn, for that wonderful job you did in saving us from those rats. But when it comes to the three imposters, I think that I would rule out number one. She had those generic names too quickly on hand for me. Number two is quiet. But number three seemed to be not the least bit disturbed about the rats leaving little trails behind them. So I'll go with number three.
Okay. Vicky?
Well, I didn't pay a damn bit of attention to anything. They said I was too busy watching you and the rats. No, I'm just going to go with number two because she looks like a rat lady.
She'll be tuning in for reruns.
She looks like an animal person.
Okay. David.
There's a whole lot of little baby rats in there. There's a ratatouille as well. I thought that...
Ratatouille?
I'm voting for number two. Don't interrupt. I'm going for number two. She wasn't concerned that the rat was escaping towards Lynn.
And she was embarrassed.
The big rat was going to get the big swan.
Well, Kitty. I voted for number one because she applauded when Lynn put his shoe on the top. She didn't want one of her pets to escape and go running around and maybe get lost.
Thank you. I didn't want them to get lost either under here. Well, the votes are all in. Number one, you have a single vote. Number two, you have two. And number three, you have a single vote. Now, let's find out who the real rat lover is. Well, the real... Ow! Oh! He bit me! Critical. Leona Pasley, please stand up and hurry. It's number two. Okay. We'll come back to you. Let's find out who your imposters are. Number one, your name and what do you do?
My name is Patsy Grady Abrams, and I'm an administrative assistant for a computer sales office.
Terrific. We're going to send you a rat. Number three, your name and what do you do?
My name is Lila Graham Pober, and I'm a yoga teacher.
Wonderful. Now, you have two incorrect votes. So you receive $500 for each one. That's $1,000 for your team. Now, Leona, can you tell us something about these little polka dot rats and the hairless ones in here? I mean, are they nice pets, really?
Well, they don't seem to like you, but
this one doesn't like me.
The polka dotted ones are mice.
The polka dotted ones down here are mice. All right. Now, these rats aren't bad rats. I mean, like, they're not going to hurt you like sewer rats or anything, right?
No, they're very tame. They rarely bite.
Okay. Yes, it tells to my finger, huh? Okay, thank you very much for being here and playing on To Tell the Truth. We're going to let you take your rats home very shortly. We'll be back to play one-on-one with someone from our studio audience right after this. Now it's time, if we can pull ourselves back together here, to play one-on-one with someone from our studio audience. So, Burton, who do you have for us today?
Well, Lynn, today we have Jeff Yoakum from Oroville, California.
Jeff, welcome. Here's your chance to play one-on-one. You're going to meet a woman who has two stories. Her name is Amy Lee. Amy, welcome. Jeff, Amy has two stories, one of which is not true. Now, if you can spot the true story, you'll win $500. So, Amy, what's your first story?
I'm a harpist who prefers rock to Bach. I play rock and roll on the harp.
Now, that may or may not be the truth, so listen to Amy's second story.
To protest a tax hike, I rode naked, like Lady Godiva, through the streets of my hometown.
Okay, panel. To help Jeff win $500, you know the routine. One question about each story. So, Kitty, we'll start with you and the harpist story.
What kind of rock do you play?
Classic rock.
David.
Which harp do you use?
Most harpists use a Lyon and Healy harp.
Okay. Vicki?
Is the harp as difficult to play as it looks?
Yes.
Monty.
Is there much call for a professional rock harpist?
No.
Okay. Jeff, that's the first story. Story number two, Lady Godiva, Kitty.
Gosh, were you naked all over?
Except for my wig.
David.
What was the tax hike that was so important that you were complaining against?
Property taxes.
Vicky.
Were you arrested?
Yes.
Monty.
Did you catch cold?
Okay. Jeff, you've heard the cross-examination. Is Amy the rock harpist, or did she reenact Lady Godiva?
Lady Godiva.
Lady Godiva,
yes.
Huh? Okay. Amy, what is your true story?
To tell the truth, I'm the harpist.
I'm sorry, Jeff. You didn't win the money, but you do get a lovely gift. And Amy, you received $1,000 for stumping Jeff. We'll be back with some hard rock harp after this.
You're watching Game Show Network. Don't miss Game World Weekend, followed by The Password 4, featuring a couple of episodes of Password.
And now here's Amy Lee playing Painted Black by the Rolling Stones on the harp. Thank you very much, and thank all of you. See you next time on To Tell the Truth. So long.
This is Burton Richardson speaking for To Tell the Truth, the Mark Goodson Television Production. From Hollywood, here's the game where knowledge is king and lady luck is queen. It's the Joker's Wild. Here's the host of our show, Jack Perry.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much and welcome once again to the Joker's Wild. Those of you who watched the last program know that we crowned a brand new champion, won one game, and before he got a chance to spin against the devil, our time ran out, so that's what we're going to do right now. Let's first reintroduce the current champion, Jay.
Okay, Jack, here he is, a traveling sales representative whose hobbies are photography and bowling. It's Tom Orsatt.
Hi, John.
Hi, Jack.
Nice to have you back. On the last program, we found out that you were a traveling salesman and you travel 500 to 1,000 miles every day, but still you get home every night.
That's right, Jack.
Is that because you don't trust somebody around the house or something? How come you come back every night?
I just want to get back.
You get back every night, and you're back, obviously, from last night, and you're right here now to take another chance. Winning a game gives you the right to play against the devil, so, Tom, come on over and face this old devil. Wheels, as you know, nothing but money and devils. Every time you spin and avoid the devil, you get the money. If you can get to $1,000 or more without seeing the devil, I'll give you $1,000 and these bonus gifts.
First, the Modern for that nice warm feeling. A freestanding fireplace from Freeway in Decorator colors designed to burn wood or accommodate gas or electric logs. The Modern from Freeway. Also, it's the Deluxe Silver Seiko portable electric typewriter. Sturdy, easy to tote, engineered to last. A gift for the entire family from Silver Seiko. Plus, solve that space problem with a Marvel 3-in-1 refrigerator. Cools, freezes, makes ice in a tiny corner of your den, playroom, or office. Marvel, a product of Dayton Walther Corporation. And the wardrobe of Catani Lingerie. Choose 12 of their sparkly designed, beautifully feminine, breathtaking lingerie from Catani of California. Lovely figure-flattering Catani Lingerie. Also, King Coil Posture Bond Sleep Sets have bonded construction designed to provide firm body support with comfort. King Coil Posture Bond. And this country casual bedroom lends rustic charm to any home decor. Note the bold lines, the handsome hardware, the rugged appeal of the design. It's country treasure from the indoor world of Armstrong. And this bonus round, Tom, is worth almost $3,200 in cash and prizes.
Tom, I'm getting a little nervous about you. The only time your eyes lit up was when Jay Stewart talked about the lingerie. I hope that's not significant.
It's not for me.
I know it isn't. All right, give him a spin and see what you got.
Okay.
Your first spin gets you 175 and 275. $275 if you stop now. If you go on and the devil comes up, you lose everything. What should he do? Stop or go, everybody? $100, $100, $200. That is a big one. $300, $400, $500, $600, $675. One more time, all right? You have $75, $50, $75. You have $875. One more spin to do it.
One more.
One more, risking $875. I can see you're going to write a song now called Just One More Time.
I'll probably run into him on the trip somewhere.
Well, listen, that was a very, very tough spot to get it in. Yeah. You lost that, but you do have your $500. That's not at risk. You keep that. And if you can win another game, you can come on back here and try again.
We'll give it a shot.
We'll do it right after these words, right here. Before we start our next game, may I remind you that any player who wins five games in a row gets this bonus gift.
It's a brand new car! It's a brand new Chevy Chevette four-door hatchback. The new rear doors make it easy to get into the back seat, where you'll find lots of leg room. The Chevette four-door hatchback has the comfort and convenience you want in a small car, furnished by Chevy Chevette.
Now on we go with our game. Tom Orstad, our champion, is eagerly looking forward to playing against this challenger.
Let's welcome an X-ray technician whose hobbies are backpacking and dancing. Meet Terry Schaub.
Hello, Terry, how are you?
Hi, Jack, fine.
So, you go backpacking. Where do you go backpacking?
Well, my husband Mark and I go backpacking in the Sierras. We make about six or seven trips every summer, and last summer, after hours of hard work, we made it to the top of Baxter Pass, which is almost 14,000 feet.
14,000 feet?
Almost, just about. Our highest altitude.
What'd you do when you got up there?
Just looked around, took pictures, congratulated ourselves for getting up there.
After all that effort, you just looked around and took pictures?
It's beautiful.
You have a lot of energy, Terry.
Oh.
I'll see how much energy you have as I show you the categories to be used in this game. They are Fast Forward Science. I'll explain that when we get to it. News 76, The Godfather, Wonders of the World, and Food and Drink. All right, those are the categories. The challenger always goes first. Terry Schaub, this won't be as hard as climbing up the top of that mountain, so spin and good luck. Joker, News 76, Wonders of the World.
I'll take News 76 for 100, Jack.
President Ford and Jimmy Carter met in three presidential debates during the 1976 campaign. Name any one of the three cities in which the debates were held.
New York?
Nope, that was not one of them. You'll pick up $100 if you can give me the correct answer, Tom.
San Francisco?
Philadelphia, Williamsburg, and San Francisco. Oh, wow. Right, you have $100. Off to a good start, and it's your spin. Joker, food and drink, and a triple.
I wrote the food and drink for 200.
A popular hot sauce made with yolks of eggs and butter is served with eggs, fish, and vegetables. Name the sauce.
Hollandaise?
Yes, that's right. You have $300. Score 0 to 300. Terry Schaub. Food and drink, a pair, and a triple.
$200.
A popular English food is called Welsh rarebit. What is the principal ingredient in Welsh rarebit?
I don't know.
Can't do it. You could win a game quickly by giving me the correct answer. For $500, what's the principal ingredient?
Beef.
That's the cheesiest answer I've heard in a long time. Cheese. Cheese is the principal ingredient. However, you get a chance to spin. Joker, food and drink, and a triple.
I'll take the food and drink for 200.
You have 300. This is a $200 question. Answer it correctly, and you've won yourself another game. Fresh orange juice spiked with vodka is a popular drink. For $500, give me the name of the drink.
A screwdriver.
You've just won $500. Congratulations. Tom, you just won yourself $1,000 all told on this program and the last program. And as for the lady you played against, Terry Schaub, Terry, I'm very sorry. I know it's always a disappointment. But backstage, there will be a nice consolation prize for you. Let's say goodbye to Terry Schaub. Bye-bye, Terry. And as for you, my good friend Tom Orsat, you get another chance to buck the odds here. So come on over and see what you can do. Here he comes.
That was a fast game.
Yeah, it was fast, but it was scary.
It was scary even though you were ahead all the time?
Yeah, especially when one of the first questions about the cheese, I didn't know what that was. Just took a guess. Stab in the dark.
Well, you did very well. You won $500 more. And, of course, once again, you have a chance to win almost $3,200 worth of cash and prizes here if you can stay away from that devil. As you know, once before, the devil came up at a very bad moment. Are you set to go?
I'm ready this time.
All right. Let's see what you can do to win that mattress set and the bedroom set and the lingerie and all the other things you're supposed to win. Give it a spin.
Okay.
There you have 75, 75, and 150. 100, 200, $300, no matter how you look at it. Do you stop or go on and risk it?
I think I told you to go last time and the devil came up, but I'm going anyway.
All right, he's risking $300. 100, 150. $250, bringing you up to $550. You now have $550 if you quit. Last time, remember, the devil came up. It's your choice. Shall he stop or go?
He said one more time.
One more time. Let's see what it brings. 35, 150, 75. Look where you are now. You're at $800. You're knocking at the door. This is where you were last time.
I'm going to stop.
Man says he's going to stop. He's not going to get burned twice. 100, 200, 300, 400, 500, 600, 700, 800. That, in addition to the money you won, you're winning all cash of $1,800. Nice going. And we'll see how you do in the next game right after. Tom Orsat's our champion. He's won $1,800 and now goes into his third game against this new challenger.
We have now a lab assistant who likes to sing country and western tunes. Meet Kathy Urban.
Hello, Kathy.
Hi.
I understand that you not only sing for your own amusement, but you actually recorded a song down in Nashville.
Yes, I was lucky enough to be listening to the radio when I heard that a company was looking for new talent. And I thought, well, I have talent, then I'll give it a try. And I did, and I recorded a record that was released a week ago.
What's the title?
Turn Off the Lights and Come Turn Me On.
I would ask you to sing it, but I'm afraid that 16 people out of the audience would rush and see how they could turn you on. So we're not going to do that. Instead, we hope you're turned on to these categories. Here they are. Categories in this game are road signs. We'll show you some. You'll identify them. James Bond, hobbies, followed by state capitals, and then we have potluck. Challenger goes first. That would be you, Kathy Urban. Good luck. You have road signs, hobbies, and a joker.
Hobbies for 100, Jack.
All right. What insects are you collecting if you have a checker spot, a great purple hair streak, and a giant swallowtail?
Butterflies?
Yes, that's right. You have $100. Your third game, Tom Orsat, good luck. Hobby, joker, and potluck.
I'll go with hobbies for 100.
What would your hobby be if you were a numismatist? Can't do it. $100 if you can tell me, Kathy.
Bird watching. I don't know.
No, it's coin collectors. Coin collectors are numismatists. However, it is your spin.
Okay.
Joker, hobbies, and road signs.
Road signs for 100, please.
Take a look behind me, if you will. And give me the three-word warning of this traffic signal.
No U-turn.
That's the one. Right. You have $200. Your spin, Tom. Joker, Joker! James Bond.
I'll go with James Bond for 200.
James Bond's superior is a crusty old retired admiral with a single letter code name. Which letter identifies this intelligence leader?
M.
M is right. You have $200. All tied up. Your spin, Kathy Irvin. Hobbies, Joker, James Bond.
James Bond for 100, please.
The very first James Bond film involved a search for a missing agent, which led 007 to an island called Crab Key. Name the first James Bond film.
Diamonds Are Forever.
No, that's not right. You'll pick $100 if you can tell me, Tom.
Dr. No.
Dr. No, yes. Yay! Dr. No, yes. You have $300. Your spin. Joker, hobbies, state capitals.
I'll take state capitals for 100.
Settlers founded the capital of North Dakota in 1872 and first called it Edwinton. Later they changed the name in honor of a German statesman. Name the capital of North Dakota.
Bismarck?
Yes, right. You have $400. Score 200 to 400. Your spin, Kathy. Doug Road Signs, Joker, and Potluck.
I'll take Road Signs for 100, please.
Look behind me again if you will. This big white H on a blue background is a familiar service sign to motorists. What does the H stand for?
Highway Patrol.
That is not correct. You could win the game with $500, bring you up to $2,300. What's the answer, Tom?
Hospital.
That's the one. You win again. Congratulations, Tom Orsak. Game number three. You're now winning $2,300, and in just a moment, you get a chance to spin against the devil. As for you, Kathy, pleasure to have you here. Wish you lots of good luck on the song which you recorded in Nashville,
Thank you.
We'll have a nice consolation prize, too. Let's say goodbye to Kathy Urban. And as for you, Tom Orsak, come on over here and face the old devil. Here he comes. Congratulations again. You're making a habit of this, which is very nice
to
you.
It is nice, yes.
Again, we are playing for the fireplace, the portable electric typewriter, the three-way refrigerator, lingerie, the double mattress, the bedroom set, all told over $3,000 worth of presents. You ready?
Ready. Got to get the lingerie.
Oh, you do? All right. You're making me nervous, Tom. Go ahead and spin. There you have 25, 50, and 200. $275. If you stop, do you stop or go?
Give it one more try.
All right, one more try. Listen to 275. 50, 50, 25. You're up to $400.
We'll give it a
He's going, risking $400. 100, 200, wow. 500, 600, 700, $750.
One more time.
75, 25, 50. Now the
four. We'll go. We'll give it a shout.
He's going to go. He doesn't want to, but he's going. And he gets 50, 75, all he got. You have just won $1,775. Let me give it to you. 100, 200, 300, 400, 500, 600, 700, 800, 900, 1,000, 1,050, 1,070, 1,075, plus the fireplace, the portable electric typewriter, the three-way refrigerator, the double mattress, the bedroom set, and the lingerie. Hard, you're a lucky man. You're winning over $5,575, and we'll be right back to who else is here on the keyboard.
Network has gone into the vaults to retrieve some programs that haven't been seen for decades. Just a little dusty. Hey, watch the lost episodes every Friday night.
You're watching Game Show Network. Up next, it's Tic Tac Dough, followed by a full hour of The Price is Right, then catch up with Game World.
Okay. And the game goes on with Tom Orsak Having won three games, he'd love to win game four and game five so he can get an automobile. Game four will have to be disposed of first, and he can only win this one if he defeats this challenger.
Let's welcome a graduate of California State University at Fullerton. Her hobbies are photography and singing. Meet Patty Hirahara.
Hello, Patty.
Hi, Jack. How are you?
What keeps you busy, young lady?
Well, since my hobby is photography, I enjoy being a wedding photographer.
A wedding photographer?
Yeah, I have an edge on my male counterpart since I can go some places that they can't.
Where, like the ladies' room, and where else can you go?
Well, when the bridesmaids are dressing and the bride's dressing.
That's right, you have a point there. And you carry those good points over as I show you the categories we're going to be using. In this game, they are movie cowboys, followed by United States Constitution, the solar system, followed by the Middle East, and finally, crossword definitions. You're up first, Patty Hirahara. Spin and good luck.
Okay.
You have the U.S. Constitution, the Middle East, and the solar system.
I'll take the solar system for 50, please.
A heavenly body which has three parts, called the nucleus, the head, and the tail, takes its name from the Greek word meaning long hair. What do we call this heavenly body?
A comet?
Comet is right, yes. You have $50. Tom Orsatt, you are spinning your fourth game. Good luck. Movie Cowboys, Joker, and U.S. Constitution.
Movie Cowboys for Hunter, Jack.
An American singing cowboy star, usually seen with his horse Trigger, co-starred in many films with his wife Dale Evans. Name this cowboy star.
Roy Rogers.
Right for $100. $450 to $100. U.S. spin, Patty.
Okay, come on, Joker.
Joker, crossword definition of the solar system.
Solar system for $100, please.
What's the name of the planet in our solar system which is named for the god of the underworld?
Pluto.
Pluto is right. You have $150. U.S. spin, Tom. Movie Cowboys, crossword definitions, and a Joker.
Movie Cowboys again for $100.
Okay. One of Hollywood's most successful actors still continues to enjoy an active Western career. His films of the 70s include True Grit and The Shootist. Name this movie cowboy.
John Wayne.
John Wayne is right, and you go to $200. And with that, score $150 to $200. We will have to call it quits for right now. Patty, you can go back to the next program?
I sure will.
And how about you, Tom?
Yes, I will.
It's a very important one for you. You've won three games. This will be the fourth. The score is $150 to $200. The score will be the same on our next program, as will the categories. And we'll come back and we'll finish it up. So good luck to both of you. And particular congratulations to you, Tom, for having won three games already.
Thank you, Jack.
For those of you who are watching, we hope you'll rejoin us in the next program to see whether Tom can win game number four, this one, and game number five, and get the automobile. Jack Barry for Joker's Wild. Goodbye, everybody.
Some of our departed contestants will also receive a selection of Romper Room toys featuring the Magic Kingdom to add more warmth, love, and laughter to your child's Romper Room years. And new electronic radar monitor with a multiband keeps drivers alert and aware of their speed, furnished by Electroalert. Also, Pop Ice, fun, delicious, a terrific freeze-at-home treat. 12 bars and assorted flavors treat your youngsters with refreshing Pop Ice. Plus, Slim Fast, the natural way to lose weight. Packed with vitamins, minerals, and natural protein, delicious and filling, you can get Slim Fast with Slim Fast. And Gino's Thick Crust Pizza, thick, tender crust feathered with meat and cheese. Look for Gino's in your grocer's freezer. The Joker's Wild is a Jack Barry and Dan Enright production.
On Game Show Network, anyone can win terrific prizes like this. Toll's five-piece coffee tea service, an elegantly designed, hand-applied border, has grace and style for your special occasions, furnished by Toll Silversmith. So register now to play any of our interactive games. Call 1-800-537-GAME. It's fast, it's fun, and it's free. Just register once and you can play forever on Game Show Network.
You're watching Game Show Network.
From Hollywood, it's everybody's game of strategy, knowledge, and fun. It's Tic Tac Dough. And now, here's our host, Sweet Martindale.
Thank you very much, Jason. Thank you. Thank you. Well, we have our current big winner back with us again, and of course he's doing very well, and he has no designs on losing. I think he very possibly could go a long, long way on the show. But we have an opponent against this young man who also has big eyes on winning. We're going to find out how they do right now as we continue. And first, here's our champion, Jay.
Okay, Wink, our current champion with winnings total in cash and prizes, $23,800. There's been a teacher and a waiter, and he's now studying acting. Meet David Muir. His opponent has been a commander in the Navy for 16 years, and his interests include hiking and racquetball. Meet Doug Williamson.
Yeah, he came out here like a winner, and I said, if you keep winning like that, I'm going to get in line, or David, I'm going to get in line to float alone from you. But you have designs on winning, too. You feel lucky today?
Oh, most certainly, most certainly. There's always hope.
Now, perhaps later we can see the group. You have a big group in the audience, and if you keep winning, you have, what, a couple of sons here? Who all do you have here?
Well, my wife and two sons are here, and I have some rented daughters. We have no daughters, so the Fouche family, our friends and neighbors...
Where are you? Hold up. There they are in the second
there's
row.
There's Debbie and Suzanne.
Rent a daughter. Yeah. Sounds like a good business. Hey, Doug, welcome, and welcome to your entire group. You've got quite a fan club here. Good luck. Doug Williamson. David Muir is our current champion. He's thus far won $23,800. How do you feel about all this, David? You came on, you won a few games, now you're up to 23.8, and you're doing well. How do you feel about it?
I'm ready to go for the second 23.8.
Well, then, let's not put it off. Here we go. Let's take a look at the categories. You'll remember these from the last show. Our subjects for this game between David and Doug are as follows. Potluck pictures, fairy tales, rivers, television cops, quotes, The Odd One, Spirit of 76, popular music, and opera. On the last show, you had tied once, and you were in the middle of your second game when time ran out, and that's what the board looked like. Now let's see what the X's and O's were. Two X's for David and an O for Doug, top left-hand corner of the board in the pot. $2,400. Now let's shuffle and move back to David Muir as he begins this next round. David?
I'd like Spirit of 76, please, in the upper right wing.
And so it shall be. Spirit of 76. On March 5th, 1770, British troops fired into an angry mob of colonialists. This massacre is known today by the New England city in which it took place. Name the city.
Boston.
Yes, the Boston Massacre. Another X goes on the board for Brother David. Let's move the categories around. In the pot now, $2,600. And Doug, you pick up where he left off.
Well, I'm going for rivers to block.
For a block, answer this question on rivers. This Vietnamese river, which is the largest on the Indochina Peninsula, and which was prominent in the Vietnamese War, forms a large delta before it empties into the China Sea. To block David, name it, Doug.
Mekong.
Yes, that's right, the Mekong River. Put an O there. Let's shuffle the categories before Doug is left on the board. Four boxes to select from. There are the subjects, David.
Fairy tales for the win, please, in the lower left.
If you answer the question on fairy tales, you will again have pulled it off. Another win would be worth $3,000 in cash. That would take your winnings total to $26,800. David, for a diagonal win and tic-tac-toe, here's your question. This fairy tale tells the story of an old woman who made a cookie into the shape of a little boy, only to have the boy come to life and run away. Now, for $26,800, according to the title of the story, what kind of cookie was the boy?
A gingerbread cookie.
You got it. That's right. For Chip Maxwell. Big ones, and son, I don't mean 300, I mean 3,000 bucks. You have now a total of $26,800 in cash and merchandise. And who knows, as we said on the last show, you may be well on your way to a second one of those things that you drive. We'll talk about that later. David, congratulations. We'll go to the board shortly. And to you, Doug Willemsen, thank you for an excellent couple of games. You win $250 for your efforts, and good luck to you, sir. I salute you. You played well. Thank you very much, Doug. We're going to take a commercial break there to see if David can beat the dragon. David, as you know, when you win and defeat five opponents, you win one of these. Now you've defeated another two. That makes seven. Three more opponents. If you beat him, you win a second one. And this is what you'll win.
Another brand new car. The all-new Buick Skyline, designed for comfort and convenience with front-wheel drive, providing impressive control and traction. Furnished by Buick. In addition, polyglycol sound shield of the noisy underside of your car. Not an undercoating. Polyglycol is a sound shield available at new car dealers only. Now back to you, Wink.
David, if you beat the dragon now, we are really going to take you. You're going to take yourself up into higher stratosphere winnings-wise. Let's see if you can do it right now. Come on over. And good luck. It is delightful to be here in this position. Behind the numbers on the board, David, I don't need to tell you. Various amounts of money and, of course, the almighty dragon. All you have to do is get to $1,000 or more and you win a prize package. Now, you know, solar power is very popular nowadays. Would you agree?
I'd agree.
All right. So, we are going to help you enjoy that old sunshine. Jay, tell him about it.
Well, first, David, you'll be dressed for fun in the sun with this active sportswear. His and hers classic separates by Catalina. Active wear, perfect for swimming, tennis, and racquetball. Daytime sportswear, beautifully detailed and finished in luscious colors and easy care fabrics. Timeless fashions from Catalina. And you can pack your sportswear in this attractive contemporary luggage from Ventura. Luggage in the softest manner with digital locks and scrubbable Duravinyl coverings and wheels on the Pullman. If it's Ventura, you're rolling smartly. And you can capture your sunny time on film with this 35mm camera. And the exciting world of 35mm SLR photography with the famous Pentax K1000 camera. Critically acclaimed for its rugged dependability, the K1000 accepts over 40 Pentax interchangeable lens, plus a full range of professional accessories. And finally, David, you'll be going someplace famous for its sunshine and beauty on your trip to sunny Jamaica, the island paradise of the Caribbean. You'll have seven exciting days of sun and fun. Compliments of Tic Tac Dough. And David, this special solar package is worth, in cash and prizes, almost $3,450.
If you don't want that trip, I'll be happy to take it off your hands. David, by the way, of course, obviously, if you win and beat the dragon, that will take your total winnings over $30,000. Good luck.
Thank you. Remember,
avoid the dragon or you lose everything. Get the chicken attack and you automatically get the dough. Now let's cover them up on the board, move them all around, 1 to 9 of the numbers. And of course, you're obviously going to get some help from your friends out there. Sometimes they've been good luck for you. Sometimes they pick the wrong numbers. Uh-huh. Where are you going to begin this time?
I have a new friend today.
Oh, a lucky one. Get rid of those old friends, brought along a new rabbit's foot.
Someone whose intuition I trust very much, so I'm going to let her call all the shots.
Okay, you want to start with her?
Yes.
And what's her name?
Christine.
Christine, my dear, he has really put you on the spot. Where is he going to begin?
Number five.
Number five it is. All right, in the center. Her intuition, is it right or was it wrong? $250. So far, great. All right, going Christine again. And go. What do you think, Christine? Come on, Christine. He's going to take your word on this. You've got to make up your mind. She grits her teeth and says number two, but she doesn't look too sure. Let's look behind number two. Is it money? Yeah, tick. That's all that's considered money. You need cash or $750. Back to you, Christine. Come on, Christine, give us a number. She's leaving it up to you. Come on, give us a number. You got several left. What did she say?
Six? Is that a six?
The funniest looking six I've ever used a thumb. All right, let's look behind number six. He needs tack to go with tick, and he's got an automatic win. Could it be behind number six? Oh, it's the dragon. The gal with perfect intuition. However, next time she'll do better.
I hope so.
She, poor thing, looked like she was standing up here. You should have been out there. She's scared to death. Just calling off numbers. Let's look at the rest of the board. 1, 3, 4, 7, 8, and 9. You had tick behind two. Tack was behind number 9. And, of course, that would have given you an automatic win. So we didn't go over 30 there, but you're not going to turn this down. A grand total so far of $26,800 in cash and prizes. And if you're ready, I'm ready. Let's meet a new opponent. All righty, here we go. Okay, Jay Stewart, who do you have to take David on in a new match?
Which, he's just starting a career as a business attorney, and his interests include trivia and golf. Meet Jeff Thomas.
We got David, a health enthusiast, and a real jogger up against a fine golfer. Tell me about your golf game, Jeffrey.
Well, I only play occasionally now, Wink, but back in college, I used to be pretty good.
How good were you?
Well, I had a 6 handicap, and I played for the college team.
You ever try to make it as a, on the pro circuit?
I thought about it, but, you know, I think I'd rather make a living with my mind than with my pitching wedge.
My doctor advised me to take up golf, said I needed iron every day, but I didn't quite go along with him. And that's sad, and for that reason, I'm going to get out of here as fast as I can. Let's look at the board and see what our categories are for the game. Jeff and David, take a look. The subjects are plays, symbols, Dans and Dons, mixed drinks, women writers, male singers, one-word names, Disney, and zoology. David, select, please, and let's begin.
Let's try women writers in the center for change.
In the center box, all right. For $300 to the pot, a little harder, but we do give you a little extra time. She was the author of the 1962 bestseller Sex and the Single Girl. Her innovations as editor of a national women's magazine have included the first nude male centerfold. First, I want you to name her and then name the magazine she edits. Here's your extra time. David, she wrote the 1962 bestseller, Sex and the Single Girl. Her innovations as editor of a national women's magazine have included the first nude male centerfold. For that center box, first, name her.
Her last name is Brown.
That's right. That's all we need. Helen Gurley Brown. Now, name the magazine she edits.
I think that's Cosmopolitan.
Right. Good for the center box. Cosmopolitan means you have an X in the center box, and we have $300 in the pot. Let's move the categories again now. Let's shuffle them all around. Jeff, this is your first shot at our big board. What subject would you like?
I think I'd like to go with one-word names, Wink.
One-word names it is, and here's the question in that category. Jeff, in a hit television series of the 60s, comedian Bob Denver starred as this bumbling character who was stranded on a desert island. Give me his one-word name.
I believe that's Gilligan.
Yes, that's right. Gilligan for Gilligan's Island. An O goes there. Let's move the categories again as they take different positions on the board. $500 in the pot, David.
Male singers, please. Lower center.
Lower center, male singers. Here's the subject. David, the male singer is in the Guinness Book of Records as the world's most successful recording artist, this particular singer. His hits have included Silly Love Songs and With a Little Luck. Name him.
Paul McCartney.
Yes, that's right. Formerly of the Beatles, Paul McCartney. Put an X there. Let's shuffle again. Another $200 in the pot. That takes it up to?
Well, I'll have to go with male singers for the block.
$700 in the pot now. All right. Male singers for a block. Jeff, to block him, this popular ballad singer of the 50s is noted for his glamorous wives as well as his hits. These wives have included Connie Stevens, Debbie Reynolds, and Liz Taylor. For a block, name him.
I believe that's Fisher.
Yes, Eddie Fisher. Good for a block. Good to know there. Let's move the categories around again. Another $200 in the pot. $900 it's worth now, David.
Male singers again. Looks like a good one.
All right. Getting a lot of action here. This male vocalist, whose daughter Natalie has followed in his footsteps, recorded such hits as Mona Lisa and Ramblin' Rose. Name him.
Nat the King Cole.
Correct. One of the greats, Nat King Cole. Put it up there. Four boxes left on the board. Let's shuffle. $1,100 what we're playing for now. Try to add to that, Jeffrey.
Well, he's got me against the wall. I have to go with mixed drinks for the block.
All right. A diagonal block with mixed drinks. Answer this and you'll do it. Jeff, this popular spirit, which is distilled from juniper, is often served with tonic or used in such mixed drinks as Gimlet's, Gibson's, and Tom Collins. For a block, name it.
I believe it must be gin.
Yes, that's right. Good for a block. All right, so we put it over there, another $200 to pot. Three boxes are left on the board. The categories that are going to show up when we shuffle will decide the outcome or could decide the outcome of the game. We'll get back to the game right after this commercial break. Don't go away.
Some of our party contestants will receive special formula Boratine. Modern brightening system gets colors brighter and cleaner than the leading all-fabric bleach, and it removes stains better, too. Also, Brunch Cookery plus 4 cookbooks from HP Books. Try Brunch for a delicious change and easy, entertaining, good cooking with HP Books. Plus, from Fire Islander, sportswear for today's woman. Smartly tailored, elegantly styled for quality and fashion. Fire Islander puts their reputation on the line. Now, back to Wink Martindale.
$1,300 left in the pot now as we continue. Three boxes left on the board. The subjects that come up could decide the outcome of the game. Let's see what they are as we shuffle right now for David. Plays, Dans and Dons, and women writers.
Wink, I'd like women writers again. Right center.
Women writers, the subject. David, the 19th century novelist Louisa May Alcott wrote this popular book about the lives of the four March sisters who grew up in a small New England town. Name the book.
Little Women.
Right. Little Women, you got it. Put it up there. Another $200 in the pot. Sharks are getting very tight. We're down to a couple of boxes now, Jeff. The categories that'll appear will determine if we have a tie game. So let's shuffle. $1,500 in the pot. The subject's male singers and one-word names. Select.
It'll have to be one-word names for the block, Wink.
Answer this on one-word names, and we will have a tie game. Jeff, here's your question. Actor Maurice Chevalier co-starred with Leslie Caron in this 1958 film about a young French girl who becomes a lady. For a tie game, name the girl, and you name the movie.
Gigi?
Right! We have a tie! And we also have $1,700 in the pot. As you know, if you've watched, and hopefully you have, because both of you are playing this game very, very well, very, very tight, we're going to show you 9 new categories now, and the pot will continue to get bigger with every correct answer from $1,700. So let's begin by looking at these subjects. Names the same, the 70s, television stars, royalty, female achievers, men in sports, bios, redheads, and anatomy. $1,700 the pot. Continue, David.
Female achievers in the center, please.
In the center, female achievers worth $300 to the pot. David, in order to raise her four children, including a future president, she worked at different jobs after her husband's death. Then at the age of 67, she joined the Peace Corps and served in Asia. First, I want you to name her and then name the Asian country in which she served. Think about that. David, in order to raise her four children, including a future president, she worked at different jobs after her husband died. Then at the age of 67, she joined the Peace Corps and served in Asia. Name her.
Lillian Carter.
Right. Name the Asian country in which she served, and you'll have the center box.
India.
Right. That's it for another $300 to the pot. Wow. Put an X there. Let's move the categories around. Reshuffle. And move to Jeff. I got a feeling these games could go on forever between you two. Let's find out, Jeff.
I like names the same, Wink.
Names the same. The subject, this is the question, Jeff. An actor named Michael, an actress named Susanna, and a World War sergeant named Alvin all share the last name. What is it?
York?
Yes. Michael, Susanna, and Alvin York. Put an O there. $200 to pot. We move the categories around. Quick shuffle takes us quickly back to David.
I'd like TV stars, please, on the left.
Television stars, popular subject always. Take a look at this picture, David. In a popular television series, this actor played Pappy Boyington. Name the actor.
Robert Conrad?
Yes, that's right. The series was Bye Bye Black Sheep, Robert Conrad. Put an X there. $200 to the pot, and let's shuffle again. We're up to $2,400 resting on this game, Jeff.
I'm not sure about this one, but it'll have to be anatomy for the block.
All right, for a block, you can block David by answering this question on anatomy correctly. These important organs manufacture hormones or other important substances. They include such types as the pituitary, thyroid, and adrenal. For a block, name them.
Endocrine glands.
Right. Put an O there. And another $200 in the pot. Good for a block. $2,600 in the pot. Let's shuffle the categories around and get back to David. David, what would you like to select from this point?
I'd like the 70s, please, Wink. Lower right.
The 1970s. Question. David, in 1979, the United States ambassador to the United Nations met with an official of the PLO and created a political uproar. This controversy led to his resignation. Name him. Time's up. Andrew Young.
Andrew Young.
Andrew Young. One of those names that just wouldn't come to you, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Let's move the categories around. 2,600 in the pot. Jeff, select, please.
I think I'll have to go with anatomy again, Wink.
Anatomy, bottom right corner of the board. One of the most delicate operations performed by surgeons involves the transplanting of the clear lens tissue, which covers the iris of the eye. Jeff, name this tissue.
I think it's the cornea.
Correct. That's right. The cornea. Put it over there. Four boxes left on the board as we shuffle with $2,800 in the pot. David?
It's anatomy for a block.
For a vertical block, anatomy, top right-hand corner of the board. David, this large muscle is attached to the lower ribs and separates the chest from the abdomen. It is the body's primary muscle for breathing. For a block, name it.
The diaphragm.
Correct. That's right. And that goes there. Let's shuffle again with three boxes left on the board, $3,000 in the pot, and Jeff, your pick.
Woo, I don't know any redheads, but it'll have to be redheads for the win.
Well, maybe you'll know more than you thought you did. Jeff, if you answer the question on redheads, you will have tic-tac-dough, and you will then have the championship and $3,200. Here's the question on redheads, Jeff. This redheaded actress has had a long and distinguished career in films and starred in such movies as The Lion in Winter, Pat and Mike, and Guess Who's Coming to Dinner. For tic-tac-dough and $3,200, name her.
Katherine Hepburn?
Yes, you got it. You got that, and we got a new champion on tic-tac-dough, a man who has now won $3,200 just like that. But it didn't seem that easy, did it, Jeff? To get to this point, congratulations to you. You'll assume the X position right after you get a chance to beat the dragon shortly. David, how you feel? Doggone it, it finally came to a close for you, but I'm sure it must have been an exciting time for you.
It's been wonderful, and I did a lot better than I hoped to do, so I'm real happy.
You're going to drive away with a new car and a grand total of $2,000. Oh, I beg your pardon, let me put a few digits to that. $26,800 in cash and prizes. Congratulations to David Muir, a good champion. We'll be right back. Jeff beat David, but can Jeff beat our mean monster? We'll find out on the next show, everybody, for Tic-Tac-Toe. Wink Martindale, bye-bye.
Some of our departing contestants will receive sleds, furniture polish, Lucas Finisher, a clean, clear, more beautiful shine, new sleds for a beautiful difference every time you dust. And try new Unison, the sleep aid proven effective to help you feel drowsy, fall asleep faster, sleep better all night. For occasional sleeplessness, new Unison. Also, Morton Great Little Desserts are the ideal individual-sized dessert for everyone in your family. Look for them in your grocer's freezer. Plus, Frosty Root Beer, cold brew to take on America's thirst. Now in sugar-free with the same creamy taste as regular Frosty Root Beer. And Nestle Iced Tea, 100% pure tea with root tea flavor that refreshes all year round. Anytime's a good time to take the Nestle plunge. This is Jack Barry and Dan Enright production.
This is Ralph Raschig of Eagle River, Wisconsin. He spent $12,000 building this structure. There's only one other building like this in the whole world. Find out what it is as we all play What's My Line? Final Soupy Sales! Elizabeth Ashley! Gene Rayburn! Arlene Francis! And the host of What's My Line, Larry Martin!
Hello, everybody.
Hello there, Larry.
How are you?
Well, everybody looks like they're going out this evening.
Yeah.
Are you going out this evening, Arlene?
I'm going out with Scarlett O'Hara.
Lord, you got a... You still have that heart there?
Yeah, I got my heart under my clover.
Awesome. That's lovely. I love that. Okay, with our first challenger, enter and sign in, please. John Moss. Panel, John Moss is a four-time world champion. We'll show the audience what title he holds. And let's start with Elizabeth Ashley.
Is this thing that you are a champion at, do you earn your living being doing it?
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, I go again. Is it a physical thing?
No.
One down, nine to go, Gene.
Is it in the category of a game?
such as a chess game, a bridge game, or something like that?
Yes.
Are there objects involved, such as cards or stones or...
Yes.
And is there a board involved?
No. 298 to go, Arlene.
Do you play this game sitting down?
Yes.
There's no board involved. Is there, are there cards involved?
Yes.
Are you a blackjack dealer?
No. 397 to go, Soupy.
But there are cards.
But there are cards involved.
Yes.
Is it anything in the rummy, hearts, or bridge family?
I have to say no to that, really.
4-6 to go, Elizabeth.
Are there dice involved?
No. 5-5 to go, Gene.
Well, now we've established it's a card game.
Yes.
And if it's not bridge, it's got to be poker.
Poker is the name of the game. John Maltz is a world champion poker player, and he earned his title at the World Series of Poker held at Binion's Horseshoe Casino in Las Vegas, Nevada. How much did you win?
109,000.
Oh.
How many guys in the game?
16.
And what were the stakes? How did you begin?
10,000 each for each player.
And you end up winning it all, huh?
Yes. Then they have other games you enter in.
How long did it take to do that?
About 7 days.
How many hours a day?
Eight.
John, your big hand that where you finally won the whole thing, what did you have?
Three trays.
Three trains?
Three trains.
Three trains.
You're some poker player.
You're the old maid, Gene.
I should have said three threes.
Yeah. How long have you been playing poker?
50 years.
What's the most important thing that a poker player has to know?
What he has, his poker face.
Oh, yeah.
He didn't even want to tell you what he was champion of. No, what is the main thing about playing poker, for example?
Well, staying sober and...
Does knowing who you're playing with have a lot to do with it?
No. Well, it has little to do with it, but...
Do you have to know percentages of cards?
Yes.
Are you bored being here?
You haven't been on television before. But you also play poker just generally, I mean, for a living. You're a full-time poker player.
Yeah, I'm a full-time poker player.
Do you have a game going somewhere? Or?
No, I have a card room at the Aladdin Hotel in Las Vegas, Nevada.
Do you remember what he held a game? Can't remember where the hotel is.
Listen, someone told me once this, the most important lesson you can learn about poker is when not to play the hand. And if you play only about every fifth hand, is that true?
Well, you have to play a hand when you get it.
Yeah, that's true.
Oh.
Listen, just for giggles, we got some poker players here, I think. Let's go backwards from the best hand you can get to the least and see what it is. Soupy, what's the best hand you can get?
A royal flush.
Okay, what's the next best hand, Elizabeth?
A full house?
I don't think so. What's the next best hand?
Four aces.
Four aces.
Oh,
four
I don't
aces.
Know. I don't know.
Okay, what's the next best hand, Gene?
I guess full house would come next, wouldn't it?
Yes.
Yeah.
Then what's the next best thing, Arlene?
Four kings?
No. I want to play with flush. Her.
A flush.
A what? What did he say?
A flush.
Flush.
Is next.
Flush.
Now where are we down to?
Now we're down to a full house. No.
No, now we're down to
straight.
Straight. Aren't we?
What? Yeah,
straight.
Straight.
Okay, Elizabeth,
straight.
Then what?
I have no idea. I've never played poker in my life.
Well, three of a kind
life.
Next, right?
Three of a kind.
Three of a kind.
Then what? Then two pairs?
Then two pairs.
Then one pair?
One pair.
Then high card?
High card.
And then I want my mommy.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for being with us all. What's my line? Congratulations. We'll be back with more What's My Line right after this message. I tell you, somebody just said that John Moss is the loosest man I ever saw.
He is cool, you know, hand
when,
Luke, isn't
when
he?
When the pressure is on and there's $160,000 on the table and he's tight and tense, he's where we are now. Okay, well, our next challenger, enter and sign in, please. Ralph Rushing.
Eagle River, Wisconsin.
Panel, some people build houses for birds, some build houses for dogs. Ralph Roschick spent $12,000 building a house for another kind of creature. We'll show the audience what it is. Let's start with Arlene Francis.
A living creature. Does it have legs?
Yes.
Is it in the primate or orangutan family?
No.
No.
One down, nine to go, Soup.
Would you say some people build houses for dogs, some people build them for birds?
Some build it for cats.
And some build for cats.
He built it for something else.
Can we rule out you built this for the Loch Ness Monster?
Yes.
Okay. Is this found in the backyard of your home?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Is it indeed for some kind of an animal?
Yes, sir.
And Arlene said it has legs.
Right.
Yes, sir.
It has four, I think she said.
Really?
Is it bigger than your average dog?
No.
Two down, eight to go, Elizabeth.
Is this animal in the bear family?
No.
Three down, seven to go, Gene.
Well, let's find out what kind of animal this is now. Is this a fur-bearing animal?
Yes.
And is it carnivorous?
No.
No.
Four down, six to go, Arlene.
Is a skunk carnivorous?
No.
No?
Herbivorous. Skunk is herbivorous.
Herbivorous. Yeah. And smelliferous.
Yeah.
But it isn't a skunk. No.
No. Yes, it is not a skunk.
Is it an animal that we are very familiar with in America?
Yes.
If I were driving along a highway, is it possible I might even see one running around?
No.
Five down and five to go, Soupy.
You wouldn't see it running around?
No, sir.
It's a rat house.
Yeah. It has four legs and is not as big as a dog.
It only has two legs.
Only has two legs?
Only has two legs?
Oh, I apologize. I misled you there. I'm sorry. I thought it had
it
four.
It only has two legs.
Son of
Does
a gun.
Is it nothing in the bird family?
No, sir.
Six down and four to go, Elizabeth.
Does this animal have to climb to get into this structure?
Yes.
It can climb to get into this structure.
It doesn't have to climb to get into the structure. So we have to call that seven down and three to go. Okay, Gene.
What are you doing to this girl? She's new on the block, and you're being mean to her.
Not at all. I'm just trying to keep everything clear.
Oh, I see. It can climb, but it doesn't have to.
Not to get That's into right. this, right?
What do you throw it up there, or what? Well, how do you? come on now.
You mean to be mean.
Now, let's see. Fur-bearing, herbivorous, two legs. Does it walk on its two legs? I mean, the two legs, the only thing
and
I can think
arms.
Of is in the kangaroo family. Is it in the kangaroo family?
No, sir.
No. That would really jump up there. Eight down and two to go, Arlene.
Now, wait a minute. It has two legs and two arms. Is that correct? It's got to have two something else.
Yes, it has two arms, but...
But you don't call them arms. You call
them... I call them legs, and you see the trouble we got into.
Yeah.
It has two other appendages. We can call them that.
And it is it is nothing in the ape family. Is the fur used for coats and things like that?
No.
One down, nine down, and one to go.
We just have a few seconds conference.
Got 5 seconds to go.
Could it be an anteater?
No.
is it
live in the
okay, world. Okay, the time is up, actually. Has anybody got a notion?
And two arms.
An otter?
No. Fish.
It is a bat.
A bat.
A bat.
Did you feel bat, Tom?
Now then, let us get into that.
I thought you said it didn't fly.
No, nobody said that. Nobody
said
asked that.
It wasn't a bird.
You said it wasn't a bird.
Bats, but I got confused.
And it isn't a bird. Why would we lie to you about a thing like
now,
that?
Now, wait a minute. Bats are carnivorous. They eat mice.
No, they don't.
They don't?
Right, now, let's find out.
Why did you build a house for them?
Why would you, since it's not my favorite little thing to have around, build a house for bats in the first place?
Well, bats are an endangered species, and
they are a very important part of our ecology. Bats are an important part of our ecology. Why?
Yes,
what do they do?
Well, they eat. Each bat eats over 150,000 mosquitoes per night, as well as moths that lay their eggs.
Let's hear it from the bat. I would have given anything for a couple of pet bats from time to time. I didn't realize that. Now, what kind of a house do they live in, and what kind do they like to live in? Well, here's a picture of it. I have it over here. Let's just show it to everybody so they'll see what the actual structure is.
That's a bat house?
That's a bat house. How many does that hold?
This tower will house 150,000 bats.
Oh, no!
Well, how big is that?
Well, the tower stands 36 feet high. And is 6 feet square.
And 150,000 can get in there?
Yes, sir.
And
they
why
have
do
no
they go
sense
there?
Of privacy
what makes
at
them
all,
want to go
they?
There?
Well, this tower is composed of a flyway. It has a nursery where the females go to have their young. It has a roosting area for the 150,000 bats. It has a hopper in the bottom where the bat guano will drop into the hopper, and it also has a cemetery.
How do you let them
wait
know
a minute,
that
wait
you
a minute,
are
hold
providing
it, hold
that
it,
you run
it.
This hotel?
Hold it. You know what the man said? It has a cemetery in there?
Yes. A bat lives between 15 and 20 years, and if it happens to expire while it's in the tower, I understand its companions will unhook it and take it and place it into the cemetery.
That's
and
nice.
And so a cemetery is set aside for this purpose.
But do they all go out together on a Sunday afternoon fly?
They must...
Only in the evening.
They go out at night after a
and I imagine they really have a crowded bathroom.
but how do they know bathroom. About it? I mean...
Fellas, we're going to have to do this when we all meet again at the end of the program because there's only so much time. I really love it, too, but thank you for being with us on What's My Line, and we'll continue later.
Okay.
We'll be back with more on What's My Line right after this message. He don't want to talk to us. Okay. Just before we push ahead... This is a bumper sticker that Ralph Rashid has. And if anybody, he does this to help raise money to protect an endangered species. And if anybody wants this, send in for it with a little donation to Batman, Eagle River, Wisconsin. It's time now for the special feature of What's My Line, the appearance of our mystery guest.
Oh,
that means it's
go.
Blindfold time, panel.
Ready.
Are they all in place?
Yeah.
Then
yeah.
Would our mystery guest enter and sign in, please? Okay, panel, we go one question at a time. Fate's law prevails. You have 2 minutes, and we'll start with Soupy Sales.
Thank you. Mystery guest, would we know you from your work on the Broadway stage?
Mm-mm.
Elizabeth?
Would we know you from your work in, like, film and television? Mm-hmm.
Jean?
Well, is it mainly television?
Mm-mm.
No? It's hard to say.
Oh.
Probably right. Recently. Arlene?
More recently, television. Uh-huh.
Well, it's one of the areas, anyway.
Are you, do you appear regularly in a series?
Mm-mm.
Soupy?
Do you appear in movies, mostly?
Mm-mm.
Elizabeth?
So it's mostly on television, is that it?
Yes.
But she's not appearing in a series?
No.
That's right.
That's what we've got. Wow.
Want to pass?
Pass?
Yeah.
Well, now, is there something, some other vocation involved here? You know, as for instance, as Bess Meyerson used to be the commissioner of something in New York, are you Are you, do you have another occupation like that in addition to your theatrical career?
Mm-hmm.
Arlene?
Well, is it Betty Furness?
Betty Furness! Telling question that you asked there, Gene.
Yeah. Very keen, Gene. Yeah. There was hardly any place to go. It was either bad for me or it wasn't.
You've really worked on all levels as consumer protector.
Yeah.
Protector.
I worked at the federal level and then for New York State and then for New York City last year.
Well, you must know more about it than anybody.
Well, I don't know that, but I guess I am the only person who's held the government job at the three different levels.
It's really marvelous that you've done that. It's a thing that needs doing, and for somebody to take the time and put the energy and to care that much is really wonderful, and we're all in your debt for it.
Oh, thank you, Larry. What I'm doing now is an extension, really, of all of that, because now I'm working on local NBC television in New York. I'm on every night on the news show doing consumer bits and responding to complaints and all of that. And that's something I've always wanted to do, because it's all very well for me to know what people ought to do, but if they don't know what they ought to do,
Well, it's very helpful, too. Now, recently you were in helped to judge a contest, didn't you?
Yeah.
It was for chairs. And we have the four winners here. Could we open the curtain, please,
for
Lloyd?
Chairs, four winners?
There are four chairs there. Now, they were judged for comfort. And we're going to ask each of you to sit in a chair.
Oh.
And there is a winner, and there are second place wins and third and so forth. And everybody sit in a chair. You have 10 seconds in each chair. We'll play some music, and when the music stops, then you just sort of change chairs. And then at the end, we'll ask you to stand behind the chair you like the best.
Now, this has nothing to do with which is the best chair or the prettiest chair or the most expensive or the cheapest. This is just comfortable, that's all. We'll figure out what our chair like best.
Do we change chairs?
Only when the music stops, Sue.
Sit down, Soupy.
Okay, now the music stopped. Okay, now everybody move over to the next chair.
Quick.
Okay, hit it.
Feel anything, honey?
What's that?
Somebody's been sitting in my
chair. Get up, Gene. Gene, you have to get up. Gene, you have to get up. Okay, new chairs. Here we go. Hold it. Everybody's now assuming the position. On your mark, get set, flake out. Okay, music. Soupy is happy.
Soupy found a greater depth than you did, Arlene, in that one chair.
He's got a bigger thing to find him.
Okay, change chairs again, everybody.
All right, get over there.
Okay, everybody comfortably situated? Oh. Okay, now everybody, pick out the chair that you like the best.
This one. I'm in this one. I like
Stand
it.
Behind the one you like the best. Soupy picks
you
out
to
one.
Get out of it?
Yeah.
Oh.
Okay.
I like this one.
Can I go over there?
Okay, sure. Okay, three picked that one, right?
Yeah.
Now, the chair that actually won...
Was that one.
Was which one?
Was this one.
Wrong. Wrong.
Now, that chair is the Haimi chair. And is made to order by Turner Limited, and with the ottoman, it costs $1,535.
Now,
it should be comfortable.
I couldn't be.
Now,
I would
three
like
of
to
you
congratulate,
have picked up.
I'd like to congratulate these three people, because they picked a chair that cost $99.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, really? Yeah. Oh, I love it.
That chair was a second-place chair, and it's a vinyl recliner from Macy's, and it's $99.
Terrific
which
chair.
Which is great. Some difference. Now, Gene picked that one. What's that one?
I love this chair.
That's tied for
chair.
Second, right?
That's the Ames chair.
That's the Ames
chair
by Herman Miller, and that one in the ottoman is $1,070.
See, I'm a classy guy.
You know, the analysts have that one. They all sit there.
And the poor little wing chair on the end there.
That's the one I picked.
That's the one I picked,
yes, when we did it for the magazine. Because I finally decided that what I like to do is sit up, not sit down. Yeah. And you really sit up in that chair.
Yes, and that one is from B. Altman's, and that one is $259, somewhere in the middle. It really is amazing that price has nothing to do with comfort.
I don't know why these rich people didn't all pick the $1,500 chair.
Well, when it comes down to it, we all come from modest beginnings. What are you trying to tell me? You're trying to tell me that we're going to break for commercial now? Lovely, we'll break for commercial, we'll be right back. Well, I bet you we'll get back to chairs if you go. We just have time to say that New York Magazine arranged for us to have the chairs and also conducted the contest. Goodbye, everybody. We'll see you.
Thank you.
Jack Gould speaking for What's My Line, a Mark Goodson, Bill Todman production. This program is recorded.
Game Show Network.
It's free. Just register once and you can play forever on Game Show Network.
You're watching Game Show Network.
This is Jeopardy! Now entering the studio are today's contestants. A teacher from Ypsilanti, Michigan, Ann Antel. A restaurant manager and a comedian from Santa Ana, California, Daniel Dorse. And our returning champion, a writer from Portland, Oregon, Eric Bergman, whose cash winnings on yesterday's show totaled $8,800. And now, here is the host of Jeopardy, Alex Trebek.
Thank you, Jenny Gilbert. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Hello, folks. Happy to have you joining us once again for a half hour here on Jeopardy. And from you, Daniel, we introduced you as a comedian. I'm expecting some laughs a little later on in the program. Good luck to you and Ann and Eric as we put the board in motion and get things all set to play our very first round on Jeopardy today. Tougher answers always at the bottom, easier ones at the top. Here are the categories for this round. American trivia, followed by show business, crime, the Confederacy, rugs and carpets, and finally, rainy songs. No need to explain about the new category we have with us today, ladies and gentlemen, rugs and carpets. You won't see that very often on our show. Eric, you can select it or not.
I'd like to go with rainy songs for 100, please.
Upper right-hand corner for this clue. In 1970, Elvis walked in the rain of this southern state. Daniel.
What is the Kentucky rain?
Right.
Show business for 100, please.
The top of that column. After going back to the future, this actor went back to his family ties. Daniel again.
Who is Michael J. Fox?
Yes.
Show business for 200, please.
Moving down one. From 1968 to 1973, Michael Cole, Peggy Lipton, and Clarence Williams III were better known as this. Daniel again.
Who was the Mod Squad?
Correct.
Show business for 300, please.
Married to playwright David Rabe, she was an unmarried woman in 1978. Daniel.
Who is Jill Clayburgh?
Right.
Show business for 400.
From 1972 to 1978, he was Bob Newhart's ego-altering alter ego. Let's hear from Ann.
Who is Bob Hartley?
Dr. Robert Hartley, absolutely right. Nice going. $400 for you. You're in second place. Select.
I'd like to try crime for 100, please.
Okay, let's see if it pays. At 664 arrests per 100,000 population, most frequent in U.S., this crime makes people mad. Daniel.
What is drunk driving?
Driving under the influence, you're right.
Crime for 200.
The crime which brought Raskolnikov punishment in Dostoevsky's Crime and Punishment. Eric.
What is murder?
Murder is right.
Crime for 300, please.
At the middle. Smuggling the fruit of genus Passiflora or killing a lover could be called this type of crime. Anne.
What is a crime of passion?
You are right.
I'd like the Confederacy for 100, please.
All righty. Of population, wealth, or quality of commanders, the one advantage the South had. Eric?
What were the quality of the commanders?
That is right.
Confederacy for 200, please.
D.W. Griffith classic, which told of war and aftermath from the Southern point of view. Anne?
What is the Klansman?
The Klansman. No. Daniel.
What is the Birth of a Nation?
Birth of a Nation, yes. It was based on the Klansman, but the film was called Birth of a Nation. Sorry about that. And Daniel, would you select for me?
Show Business for 500, please.
The answer? 1978 saw him going south with Mary Steenburgen. Daniel?
Who was Jack Nicholson?
That is right for another $500, and you're up to $1,500. Good beginning for you. Select again.
Well, then...
There we go. Get some applause for you. You deserve it. Select.
We might as well find out what rugs and carpets are for $100.
Certainly. Today's Persian rugs come from this country, which used to be Persia. Daniel?
What is Iran?
Right.
Rugs and carpets for $200.
It's peachy keen that this southern state makes about 60% of all U.S. carpet. And?
What is Georgia?
You are right.
I'll try rugs and carpets for $300.
Answer this time is an Audio Daily Double. And you're in second place with $700. Hard to imagine an Audio Daily Double in a rugs and carpets category, I'm sure. How much are you going to risk?
$10. I never know the songs you play.
All right. Daniel is supposed to be the comic on this program, but you're risking $10. Here comes the music. Now, let me give you the clue. Kind of carpet in title of the following. Listen to a bit of the music.
What is a magic carpet?
Absolutely right! Way to go, Ed! The song was by Steppenwolf. And you know, in the year and third that we've been doing this program, that is the least amount of money ever wagered by a contestant on a Daily Double. But not to worry. We're going to take a commercial break right now. We're off and running. We got a great start. And hope you'll stay with us. We'll be back with more on our magic carpet ride following this.
I'm the freshest, fastest, and coolest way to turn cyber letters. If you like Wheel of Fortune, you'll love Wheel 2000. Everyone in your family can play along and learn something too. What about that? Did I mention the fabulous prizes? Hey, we're not talking Rice-A-Roni here, buddy.
Wheel 2000 starts this fall on Game Show Network.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, we're going to spend a few moments chatting with the lady who just picked up a big $10 on that Audio Daily Double. Ann Antel from, is it Ypsilanti?
Yes.
That's the correct pronunciation?
That's
good,
correct.
Good having you with us. We got you as a result of a contestant search we did in conjunction with WDIV.
Yes.
We're popular on that station. I hope you watch us a lot.
I watch you every night, and when I can't watch you, I tape you.
Oh. This is sounding very interesting. You're into astrology, aren't you?
Yes, I am.
Tell me about that.
I became interested in it because I found that it made very good conversation when you didn't know what to say.
Mm-hmm.
And then I found that it worked. So I learned how to do charts.
Did you do your chart prior to coming on the show today?
Yes, I did.
Did it say you were going to have good success?
Well, you see, the stars never lie, but I sometimes make a mistake. So
okay.
I'm gonna just...
All right. The man next to you hasn't made many mistakes so far on the program. Daniel Dorris from Santa Ana. Where are you from originally?
Actually, I was born in California, but when I was 3 weeks old, my parents moved back to Britain, and I decided, what the heck, I'll go with them.
Uh-huh. A wise move on your part. Yeah. When did you come back here?
When I was 12.
Love your accent.
Thank you.
Adds a touch of class to our program. And our champion has added a touch of class, picked up $8,800 on our last show. You enjoy bird watching.
Yeah, sure do.
What's been your most successful day in bird watching? How many have you seen? Or was it a rare bird you saw?
I think the type of birds I see is more important than the numbers, and I really love to see the eagles. So last year, a trip I took to Africa, which is the continent with the most number of eagles, was really a great trip.
Okay. Good having you back with us, Eric. Right now, you're in third place, and Anne is in control of the board, so make a selection.
I'd like the Confederacy for 300, please.
Middle of the column. The number of years the Confederacy was in existence. Anne?
What is five?
Five, we'll accept that. It was 4 years, 2 months, and 5 days, as a matter of fact. Select again.
The Confederacy for 400, please.
Answer. To court aid and recognition from England and France, the Confederacy offered this white gold. Eric.
What is cotton?
That is correct.
Confederacy for 500, please.
Last clue in this category. In the 1862, fearing collapse of armies, the Confederate Congress passed the first law of this kind in American history. Eric?
What is martial law?
No, sorry. Daniel?
What is the draft?
The draft, absolutely right. For $500 more. Select.
Okay, rainy songs for 200.
Back to that one. For 19 weeks in 1969 to 70, raindrops kept falling on his head. Daniel?
Who is B.J. Thomas?
Right again.
Rainy songs for 300.
According to Albert Hammond, it never rains here, but man, it pours. Eric?
What is Southern California?
That's correct.
Rainy songs for 400.
Neil Sedaka chuckled all the way to the bank with his number one comeback song in 1974. The song is called Laughter in the Rain, and we've got about a minute left in this round. Eric, select.
American trivia for 100, please.
All right, let's start in this category. Old Joe is the name of the animal on this pack of cigarettes. Anne.
What are camels?
Right.
American trivia for 200, please.
From contraction of the French phrase sans caffeine comes this brand of coffee. Anne again.
What is Sanka?
Correct.
American trivia for 300, please.
Song based on the poem The Defense of Fort McHenry. Daniel.
What is the Battle Hymn of the Republic?
No. Eric.
What is the Star-Spangled Banner?
That is correct.
American trivia for 400, please.
The USS Nevada was the only ship present at both Pearl Harbor attack and this epic European event. Eric.
What was the invasion of Normandy?
Right, D-Day.
American trivia for 500,
please. Last clue is, in 1939, Warners of Connecticut gave bras these for the first time. Anne?
What is padding?
No. Sorry. Daniel or Eric? They gave them cup sizes. They started sizing. Eric, select again.
Crime for 400, please.
Crime for 4. Crimes punishable by less than 1 year sentence are usually classified as this. Daniel?
What is a misdemeanor?
That is right. Oh, and that wraps it up for this round. And let's see, Daniel, you've added to your lead. You've got twice as much money as our returning champion, Eric, and Anne has 810. Relax for a few moments. We'll set the board up for Double Jeopardy. We'll be ready for that after this.
I told you you can't take this to work.
Any teas?
No more playing until you clean up your house.
Thanks to Electronic Wheel of Fortune, kids aren't the only ones who behave like children.
Give me a seat.
I'm counting to 10, and then we're leaving without you.
Puzzling behavior can be traced to 400 real puzzles from America's most popular game show.
I'd like to solve the puzzle.
Tomorrow, Dad, I'm going to sleep.
Get Electronic Wheel of Fortune with thousands of new puzzles and expansion cartridges, but please, act your age.
Welcome back. Anne is going to select first as we put the dollar amounts into the monitors for this Double Jeopardy round. And I'll remind all three players that we will have the two daily doubles helping you in this one. Here are the categories. The continents, childhood diseases, surfing, the Odyssey, animals, and finally, double end. Anne, off you go.
Childhood diseases, please, for 200.
Top of that column, this clue. Every year, Jerry Lewis hosts the telethon to help his kids who have this disease. Daniel.
What is muscular dystrophy?
That is right.
Surfing for 200.
Surfing for 2. What a surfer refers to when he talks about his blue cheer, Gordon Smith, or Hobie. Daniel.
What is his surfboard?
Right.
Surfing for 400.
Moving down one. When winter waves are highest, surfers flock to famous north shore of this populous Hawaiian island. Daniel.
What is Oahu?
That is correct.
Surfing for 600.
What it's called when a surfer loses both his balance and his board during a ride. Daniel?
What is a wipeout?
That is right.
Surfing for 800.
Answer is a daily double. Daniel is having a lot of fun in this category. Obviously knows a great deal about surfing. How much is he willing to risk, however, on this daily double answer?
Well, remember, I was born in California. Let's say 1800.
For 1800, here is the clue for you. Two of the three top 20 hits the Beach Boys sang with Surfin' or Surfer in the title.
What is Surfin' USA and what is Let's Go Surfin'?
Oh, sorry. Surfin' USA is correct. Surfin' Safari is the other one and Surfer Girl. Surfer Girl. Daniel, you lost a bit of money on that, but you're still in control of the board and you've got $2,000, so select.
Let's go surfing for 1,000.
At the bottom. challenging maneuver of riding the face of the wave while staying under its breaking point. Daniel.
What is...
Oh, sorry. Drew a blank at the wrong moment. It cost you $1,000. Eric or Ann, let me give it to you. What is riding the curl? Shooting the curl? Does that sound familiar, Daniel?
Yes.
All right. Select again.
Childhood diseases for 400.
For 400. The answer is, after accidents, this SIDS disease is leading cause of death in children up to 1 year old. And
what are crib death?
Crib death, sudden infant death syndrome. Yes.
Childhood diseases for 600, please.
Disease which makes kids look like connect the dots. Same virus can cause shingles later on. And
what is chickenpox?
You are right.
Childhood diseases for 800, please.
Due to sugar, additives, and preservatives in processed foods, that overly rambunctious kids might be this. Eric.
What is hyperactivity?
Hyperactive or hyperkinetic, you are correct.
Animals for 200, please.
The answer is direction a warthog's tail points when running. And
straight up. What is straight up?
That's it.
Childhood diseases for 1,000, please.
Amblyopia. It could be called the indolent optical organ affliction. And
what is lazy eye?
That is absolutely right. $1,000 more for you, and you're in the lead by over 1,000. Make a selection.
Can I have the Odyssey for 200, please?
Yes. Answer? Very brief. It's author. And
who is Homer?
Correct.
Odyssey for 400, please.
The sirens try to lure Ulysses and his men to death by this vocal approach. And
what is singing?
That's right.
I could do that. What's the Odyssey for 600, please?
Basically, the Odyssey picks up where this, the author's earlier epic, leaves off. And again.
What is the Iliad?
Right.
The Odyssey for 800, please.
For 7 years, Ulysses was held captive by this sea nymph, the symbol of the Cousteau Society. And again.
Who is Calypso?
Correct.
The Odyssey for 1,000, please.
Relationship of Telemachus to Ulysses. And
what is sun?
That is absolutely right. Nice going. You ran that category, and you ran your lead up to a beautiful total of 6,010. Make another selection.
Animals for 400, please.
Answer there. Besides hearing, one of two other main functions of the elephant's huge ears. Eric.
What is fanning away insects?
That's right.
Animals for 600, please.
The only wild sheep in Western North America. It's sometimes called the Rocky Mountain sheep. Eric.
What is the bighorn sheep?
Right.
Animals for 800, please.
The second largest bird in the world is this Australian native. And
what is the kiwi?
No, sorry. Daniel.
What is the emu?
Emu is right for 800.
Double N for 400.
The answer is, with this auditory condition, the bells ringing for me and my gal might be in your ears. And
what is tintinnabulation?
No, sorry.
Tintinite.
Daniel or Eric? What is tinnitus? Tinnitus. Daniel, select again.
Double N for 200.
At the top. Nook's companion. Daniel?
What is cranny?
That is right.
Double N for 600.
Two of four U.S. states that fit this category. Two of four U.S. states that fit this category. What are Connecticut, Minnesota, Pennsylvania, and Tennessee? Daniel, go again.
Animals for 1,000.
The bottom of that column. One of the few tool-using animals, this ocean mammal opens muscles by using stones as anvils. Eric.
What is the sea otter?
That's absolutely right for $1,000 more. We've got about a minute to go in this round.
Continents for 200, please.
Top of the category. Four of the seven continents begin with this letter. N.
What is A?
That is right.
Continents for 400.
Answer. Daily double. Chance for you to add your lead, Ann. How much are you going to risk?
500.
For 500. Here is the clue for you. The four continents generally considered to border the Indian Ocean.
Africa.
Phrasing.
What are Africa, Asia, Australia, and Antarctica?
Absolutely right. Nice going. We've got 5,510. Select again.
The continents for 600, please.
Middle of the column. It has nearly three times the population of any other country in Europe. It has nearly three times. Daniel.
What is the Soviet Union?
Yes, European Russia. Right. Oh, there we go. That's it. We're out of time. And let's see. Daniel was leading early on.
And he faltered, and Anne came on, and she's in the lead right now with Eric in second place. All three of you, however, are still very much alive as we get set for Final Jeopardy. Remember, the champion keeps the cash, and here are the prizes we have for our runners-up.
Today's second-place contestant will receive the collection from Shapiro & Son. This beautiful bedspread, pumped with Cordell Fiberfill, is enhanced by a matching ensemble, handcrafted elegance from Shapiro & Son, and the exclusive Space Mates laundry pair, full-size stackable washer and dryer that can install in 27 inches. Front-loading washer uses less water, detergent, and bleach than top loaders. Electric or gas dryer available from White Westinghouse. Today's third-place contestant will enjoy the incomparable luxury of the Carrera recliner. This recliner is more than big. The cushions are more than thick. It may be the biggest, most billowy chair that you've ever sunk into. Action Recliners by Lane. And now back to Alex Trebek.
Who will be our Jeopardy champion at the end of today's program? These three contestants are going to make their wagers based on this category. The 1940s. That'll help determine the championship. We'll reveal the answer following this commercial message for you.
Hi, everybody. I'm Dave Nemeth.
And I'm Nancy Sullivan. Join us on Game TV.
Our guest will be Dane Chapin, the president of the company that makes Hollywood Monopoly. It has some of your favorite Tinseltown landmarks.
Now, if you'd like to talk to Dane, just watch Game TV beginning at noon Eastern.
Then when we ask you to call in, pick up your phone, dial 1-800-540-0GSM.
Look, Dave, I already bought property. Oh, these cards are so big.
No, I want to play. Where are the dice?
Well, they wouldn't fit in the door.
Don't miss Game TV, weekdays at 12 p.m. Eastern, 9 a.m. Pacific.
Welcome back. During the commercial break, we made a telephone call to the Motion Picture Academy to make one final check on one of our answers on the program today, and they informed us that in its initial release, Birth of a Nation was called The Klansman. So that is why the score that appears in front of Anne right now is different from the one that was there a few moments ago. We have credited her with $400. She has made her wager based on the total you see in front of her, and all of our players have made their wagers to this point. On our Final Jeopardy category, which is the 40s. When I give you the answer, 30 seconds is what you'll have in which to come up with the correct question. Here it is. The answer, Mussolini, Hitler, and FDR all died during this month in 1945. Good luck, players. We're going to begin with Daniel Dorse. He was in third place with 2,600. He's shaking his head. He doesn't seem very confident on this Final Jeopardy. Let's see what he wrote down. What is November? I'm sorry, that is wrong, Daniel. How much did you risk? All of it. Nice move on your part. Gutsy move. You wind up with nothing, however. And so we move down here to Eric Bergman, who is our returning champion, was in second place with 4,000. What did he put down? What is May? Sorry, that too is incorrect. And that'll cost you $3,999, leaving you with $1. We move down here to the lady who's in the lead. Remember, Anne Antell is into astrology. You would think she would be very conversant with a lot of important dates in history. She had 5910. Did she get the right question? What is April? She absolutely did. And that means she's going to become our new champion with how much money? $2,200 more, giving you a total of $8,110. Anne, congratulations to you. Nice going. We'll see you on our next edition of Jeopardy. Join us then, too, won't you, folks? So long, everybody.
Today's second and third place contestants will receive new from Lipton four delectable varieties of long grain and wild rice, like chicken stock and herbs. New Lipton long grain and wild rice, side dishes with that delicately seasoned taste. New improved shake and bake coating mix for chicken. A special blend of seasonings makes it an even better recipe for crispier, crunchier chicken. Reese's naturally flavored peanut butter chips for great peanut butter taste in cookies and brownies. Delicious peanut butter chips made from real peanuts. Long-wearing nail color lasts through work, lasts through play. Long-wearing nail color by Maybelline lasts and lasts. Gitano Sportswear, fashion that fits. Your style will never be the same. Now at a department store near you. We'll be right back. is Johnny Gilbert speaking. Jeopardy is a production of Merv Griffin Enterprises and distributed by
Columbia TriStar Television.